I think you can get through there.
Hey, good evening, everybody. We're really glad you're here. My name is Paula Cratium, and this mic is really loud, so I apologize. And I'm president of the Porter Ranch Neighborhood Council. Our community, all of us, whether you live in Porter Ranch, Chatsworth, Granada Hills, or Northridge, or any of the surrounding areas, have all been through a crisis together. And we continue to try to navigate this together to find good answers. And that's what we're here tonight to try to get, good answers and good solutions, not only for the now, but for our future, so that when you guys move back in your homes and your children and grandchildren are playing in your yards, you're gonna feel safe. And that's what we're working towards. So just wanna thank you for being here tonight. Our host is Pastor Dudley Rutherford, and he's gonna come up and greet you.
Good evening. Let's try that one more time. Good evening. We want to thank you. As Paula mentioned, my name is Dudley. I'm the pastor here, and we are honored that you are here. We're sorry about all the construction, but that's going to take a few more months before all that's completed. I also apologize for the stage, but before Easter, we have a thing here at the church called the Passion Play, where we show the last week of Jesus' life in Broadway form. So that's why that all looks like that, so just so you know. Tonight is all about information. You're going to hear a lot of information. But the main thing, and they'll stress this, the government officials and legislatures that are here, they're going to give a lot of time to answer your questions. They're going to let you ask questions, and they're here to answer your questions. You've got them, I've got them, and we've been waiting for a night like this to get the government officials. We do not need or want to berate them. They're here to help us. And so when you ask those questions, be kind and considerate. And I know some of you are frustrated, but we're praying for you. We're praying that that leak gets fixed as quickly as possible. And we pray for all the people on this stage, that they will come up with solutions and be able to help us and encourage us. So I hope when you leave here tonight that you feel encouraged, that there's a lot of people working on this. So I'm going to turn it over to Mitch Englander, which is our city councilman who represents this area. And he, along with all these people, have been working tirelessly around the clock to fix this problem and to help you. So would you please put your hands together and welcome our city councilman, Mitch Englander.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Pastor Rutherford. Really appreciate it. Before I say anything, I want to say this. I want to take the time to thank a few people that really deserve a tremendous amount of not only respect, but gratitude from all of us. First and foremost, this leak here, this disaster, this catastrophe isn't just here in Porter Ranch. Apparently, the leak doesn't know zip codes, and people in other areas have also been complaining and relocated as well. But your neighborhood councils, particularly the Porter Ranch Neighborhood Council led by Paula, who has just been tirelessly working on your behalf, is incredible. But her whole team and the entire Porter Ranch Neighborhood Council, as well as Chatsworth and Northridge and Granada Hills, all the stakeholders that have come together in the homeowner associations, if you think about what LAUSD did in just a few weeks by relocating the students, and I know it's really difficult to deal with that. I know how complicated that is, and I've been over at the schools as well. But the teachers that work through their vacations to set up the classrooms, and for those of you that haven't been out there on site, you would think those classrooms were there for years. I met with a lot of the students, and they were just happy to be back at school. They didn't care what school, as long as they saw their friends. So we're going to get through this. And there's two words that I want you to think about as we do. Never again. This will never happen again. And so the way that this never happens again are by these folks right here. Our lives, our future is in their hands, in making sure not only that this leak is stopped and getting the answers to all the questions and the frustrations that we all have, but working with our regulators, toughening the laws, changing the legislation. And I know we have our senators and assembly members here that are going to speak a little to that and what their hard work and what they're doing in both in Sacramento and certainly the folks in Washington to change this forever, to make this and continue to make this one of the greatest communities to live and work and raise a family. I love living here and representing you as well. So hang in there, we'll get through this as we have with every other major disaster, and we've been through a lot together. We'll get through this as well. So thanks for coming out tonight. I really appreciate it. God bless you. Thank you. Now I'd like to introduce, Fran Pavley, please, come on out. Let's give a big warm welcome for our state senator. Thank you so much.
Good evening, everyone. Pleasure for me to be here. I'm Fran Pavley, I'm your state senator. And I feel like my car knows the way here. This is my third time this week. I've been out here, been on a tour of the site. Monday, several of you were there. We had a press conference with Senate Pro Tem De Leon, Senator Bob Huff, as well as Senator Ben Allen to announce a package of bills relating to make sure, as Mitch Englander said, this will not happen again, and we want to get this right. But I also wanted to acknowledge the hard work of my staff. This isn't the first week we've been out here and attending meetings or holding meetings in my office with Save Porter Ranch, as well as the Porter Ranch Neighborhood Council leaders. So please join me in thanking my staff who's here, Rosalba Gonzalez, Dusty Russell, Henry Stern. They're all here tonight, giving up a Friday night. Your hearings last week, my staff attends it. We post things on Facebook. You've probably seen that. We have a way to link to the legislation so you can see what we will be doing regarding making sure this happens again. I'm very concerned that after the leak stops, and it will stop, after it leaks stops and the media goes away, people may just forget about what happened here. Carrying legislation to provide that oversight, hold agencies accountable, hold elected officials accountable is incredibly important as we move forward together. So if you're interested in looking at the package of legislation, and I've had nothing but good feedback, we'll be glad to provide to you that information. The first part of the legislation is an urgency item. It requires two-thirds vote of the legislature. And before those oil wells continue pumping natural gas into the reservoir, they're going to have to prove that it's safe. PUC, CEC, and others will look at this, signing off on it, and we'll have an independent review. That legislation should be heard in the next week or two in the legislature. It was introduced last week. And again, I welcome your input on this. But I also wanted to give a shout out to Paula, as everyone else will. She is amazing because she has an ability to encourage us to do more, not abrasive, but sincere, passionate on what she's doing, and has a great way to deal with elected officials as well as your community. So I appreciate that, and so does my staff. Finally, those people sitting behind me, most of them coming from far away, are spending the evening with you because it's important to the governor, it's important to myself. And a special shout out to Wade Crowfoot, who I believe is over here. He's the Deputy Secretary for the Office of Emergency Services. He's the one who's done a great job at coordinating all the other agencies so that there's one website, one voice to disseminate information in a timely way. And that is for your benefit, but also for all our benefits, so that we work collaboratively together to solve this problem. So with that, I want to thank you very much for your attendance, and I look forward to listening to the questions you have. I'm here to learn from you. Pleasure and honor to represent you up in Sacramento. And Also in Sacramento, your assembly member is Scott Wilk, and Scott was in my office for an hour or two on Thursday, and we were talking about the legislative package, so I'll be working closely with Scott on this.
Thank you, Senator. Pleasure to be here with you this evening. I wish it was under better circumstances. I want to thank Pastor Dudley and Paula and Shepherd of the Hills for hosting this. It's an incredible venue to do this in. And as Senator Pavley said, this issue is not a Republican or Democratic issue. It's about us. And I am going to be co-authoring her series of bills because, as Councilman Englander said, this should never happen again. I'd like to quickly introduce my staff. I have my district director, Chris Huff, Tammy Stevens, and Patsy Ayala from my staff. They're here to serve you. Right now, if you are going through the relocation process or other things with Southern California Edison, and they are not meeting your customer satisfaction, I'm going to give you my personal cell phone right now. I want you to call me, and I will be your advocate with them. So my personal cell is area code 661, number is 713-4794. Give it to you one more time, 661-713-4794. A couple quick shout-outs, and then I'm going to be off. One, the Porter Ranch Town Council. They're keeping everybody's feet to the fire, so they're doing a great job representing you. And then I also want to thank Governor Brown for putting this together. And we have tremendously talented people up here, you know, agency heads and people with with technical skills to answer your questions. I'm going to sit here in the front row with Senator Pavley and take notes and learn from you. And again, if you have any problems, call me. That's what I'm here for. And again, thank you for attending tonight.
All right, well, good evening, everyone. My name is Mark Ghilarducci, and I am the director of Governor Brown's Office of Emergency Services. And I'm going to kind of MC the event tonight to help you be able to hear from the panelists, and also so that we up here can hear from you and be able to share information back and forth. But before I start that, let me just say that I've been doing emergency services for about 30 years, and I've dealt with and responded to many disaster situations, both natural disasters and man-made disasters. And I can tell you this with 100% confidence, that at the worst of times, I have seen communities time and time again come out, and the best of the community comes out to be able to rally around each other, the issue, to be able to come together, to be able to solve the problem. And I will tell you this also with 100% confidence, that this issue here, like every other disaster that I've managed, is not just a government solution. It is a whole of community solution. It is us working with you, you working with us. We are collectively, we are the community. And it takes a community to be able to respond, to recover, and to ensure that in the future, we do not see these kinds of things again. This is very critical. Now, the governor and I were here about 4 weeks ago, went to the site, and then sat and had the opportunity to meet with the Porter Ranch Neighborhood Council board. Of course, as you know, shortly after that, the governor did proclaim a state of emergency. That does not mean that there was not a lot of action beforehand. In fact, from almost the moment of the knowledge of this event, there were many responders, state agencies, local government responding to begin the process of working with Southern California Gas to ensure accountability, to make sure that they were doing everything they possibly could to fix this problem, to stop the leak. And now the governor has directed us tonight to ensure, by sending down his top-level cabinet officials, to sit and talk with you tonight to ensure that not only everything that is being done continues to be done, but that in the future, as we move forward, whether collaboratively working with the legislators in introducing and supporting legislation through the actions through the emergency order, or in fact ensuring and absolutely holding accountable Southern California Gas for all of the recovery that's necessary to get you and your lifestyle and your homes back online, and that you build that confidence back in that you live in the beautiful community that Porter Ranch is, in a safe and secure environment. So with that, I want to introduce tonight to you the various panelists that have come down as a part of Governor Brown's cabinet. President Michael Picker, who is the president of the California Public Utilities Commission, will be speaking shortly. Secretary John Laird, who's secretary of the California Natural Resources Agency, and many of the departments and agencies that are actually responding to on the ground to be able to deal with this particular crisis. Secretary Matt Rodriguez, who is the secretary of the California Environmental Protection Agency. Executive Officer Richard Corey, from the California Air Resources Board. Chief Deputy Director Drew Bohan from the California Energy Commission. And Chief Deputy Director Jason Marshall from the California Department of Conservation. And Acting Director Lauren Zies from the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessment. So all of the agencies that are working on this event, including mine, are here. The heads of those departments, the leads of those agencies are here to speak to you tonight about actions and moving on in the future. So with that, I'm going to have each of the panelists present a little bit of information to you, but the bulk of the night is going to be spent with you sharing information with us. So with that, let me start off by introducing President Michael Picker of the California Public Utilities Commission.
Thank you for having me here tonight. I've had a long week, so I'm just going to stay seated, and it'll also probably make it faster so people don't shuffle back and forth. The Public Utilities Commission is first and foremost an economic regulator, so we set rates for the use of the storage facility for different and figure out how different customers are going to pay their fair share. About 25% of the storage is used for residential gas for heating and cooking in people's homes. Another 25% roughly is used for electric power plants through the basin, including Burbank and the City of Los Angeles' power plants, a couple other public agencies in Southern California Edison. And about another quarter goes to petroleum and oil facilities for their use. And the other 25% is pretty much split up. And so we have some very specific safety authority over gas pipelines, things that are close to the surface, but nothing below the wellhead. So when my staff first told me about this, I knew that we were actually going to have to work with the agencies who actually know more about wells to be able to get to solutions. And they had already been active on this, the Department of Oil, Gas, and Geothermal Research. But we immediately started to work with them. Now, while we don't have a lot of legal authority on wells themselves, we have a general authority to ensure that utility infrastructure is both safe, that it's reliable, and that it's affordable. And so we take that safety responsibility very seriously, which is why we actually started to work with the Division of Oil, Gas, and Geothermal Resources to try to find solutions. We're pretty active on four different levels, and the first is to get the well closed. That's actually the most important thing right now. But we're also, and have been for some time, tracking expenditures. At some point, once we understand better what caused this, we will there will be cost allocation and potential penalties. It's early to say, because we have just started the third area, which is our investigation in collaboration with the Division of Oil, Gas, and Geothermal Resources. Both of us have slightly different responsibilities, and the information that we need to actually take action on them are going to be different. But we've been working very closely with the Division of Oil, Gas, and Geothermal Resources to make sure that we're asking all the questions, that we're sharing the information, and to the extent possible that we're sharing the analyses so that we'll both be effective when it comes to taking any kind of enforcement actions that might result from an investigation. There'll be several steps for us. But the fourth area that we've been very busy on involves our energy division, and that's that ensuring that the infrastructure is reliable. And because many different users depend on the gas that's at this facility, we have to begin to plan now for cold events. We need to plan for the use of gas for electricity into the summer, and we need to begin to plan for next winter when people actually need that a source of gas to be able to provide for their home heating use and cooking. So those are the four things that we're most focused on, and if we get to questions, I may be able to answer some of them. But at this point, I'll turn the microphone back over to Director Gulerducci.
I'm good. Thank you, Michael. Next, we'll have Secretary John Laird of the California Natural Resources Agency.
Thank you very much. And for those of you that don't know the Natural Resources Agency, it's 19,000 people protecting the resources of the state, well known as fire, delivering water to here, energy, parks, fish and wildlife. But what is most of issue tonight is that the Department of Conservation with the Division of Oil and Gas has been on the ground from the first day of this, deals with the regulatory and transparency matters through that division, and the Energy Commission also deals with gas sustainability, certain issues. We have the Chief Deputy Director of both departments up here to answer questions, and we have a new director who's been on for days, who's watching Ken Harris by webcast tonight and has been working really hard to get up to speed the way the rest of us are on this. And I think the just one thing I wanted to say, so I have a long career of many decades in public service, and I was an elected leader of the city of Santa Cruz when a few years before Northridge, when we had a 7.1 earthquake that destroyed our downtown, closed it for 2 years. Hundreds of people were dislocated from their house. Businesses we worked hard to keep going. And I had a similar experience when I was in the legislature where the largest underground contaminated spill of perchlorate in Northern California was where 1,500 people had their own private wells. For years, they could not use their water for their personal use, shower, drink, animals. It had to be bottled in. They had questions about safety. They had questions about the varying readings. They had questions about when it was going to end. And it is somewhat analogous to this. And so I knew my role in those situations, and my role in this situation is to bring the sense of urgency of people that don't necessarily have answers, that are dislocated, that wonder how the effects on them, whether it's their property, their health, their kids, where their schools are, how the urgency of that being the life experience every day is reflected in the agencies and how they deal with this, provide information, ride herd on it, and help people work through to get to the end. So I am anxious to hear from you, and I think that's going to be very important to us in doing our jobs, in making sure that we have everybody tuned into the right place to make sure you know what we know when we know it as we move forward.
Thank you, Secretary Laird. Next is Secretary Matt Rodriguez, the California Environmental Protection Agency.
Be safe. Yes, thank you very much. It's a privilege to be here today talking to all of you. I am the Secretary for the Environmental Protection Agency, and I know that you're hearing a bewildering number of agencies and departments and boards mentioned here today. Within Cal EPA, we have six boards or departments or offices, including the Department of Toxic Substances Control, the Department of Pesticide Regulation, and importantly for tonight's purposes, the Air Resources Board and the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessments. Just a word on my role. I came to Cal EPA from having worked in the Attorney General's office for 24 years. And what I see my role as is to make sure my boards and departments and offices within the agency are implementing the laws that have been adopted by our legislature. But importantly, it's also my role to make sure that we're all working together and that we're all working collaboratively. I was mentioning to Director Ghilarducci that we saw each other on Tuesday when we were in San Diego to discuss water quality issues and potential flooding issues down on the San Diego border. And I was there with other representatives from the agencies in California. And Secretary Laird participated by phone. And yesterday we were discussing water quality issues and how we're dealing with water supply issues in California, and Secretary Laird and I were on a panel together yesterday. So part of my role is to make sure that we're all working together. In this particular instance, there are two parts of California Environmental Protection Agency that are playing a role in dealing with the gas leak situation that we're confronting right now. First off, there's the Air Resources Board. The Air Resources Board deals generally with air quality issues in California. Importantly, they are responsible for our climate change programs. They're responsible for monitoring emissions of greenhouse gases, including methane. And in this particular case, the governor has very appropriately assigned them responsibility for doing monitoring and monitoring the air in this particular vicinity. We have the executive director with us tonight, Richard Corey. And Richard was telling me that on the Air Resources Board's website, you can find actual data on emissions, both methane and benzene, on their website going on from the leaking well here. After this work is done and the well has been dealt with, the Air Resources Board will also be responsible for working with the Energy Commission, with the Public Utilities Commission, with the Division of Oil, Gas, and Geothermal Resources to look at our laws governing this kind of gas storage facility and make recommendations on what we should be doing to better regulate these areas, make changes as necessary. So that will be the role of the Air Resources Board. Also, they'll be looking at the question of how do we mitigate, from a climate change perspective, the emissions of methane that have gone on here. The other entity that is represented here tonight is the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessments, which is a mouthful to say, but they play a very, very important role in California, and a unique role, actually, in many ways. Not many states have the benefit of an office like this one. Basically, what we have in California is an office composed of scientists who work with the other agencies in California to do peer review of the work that they're doing, to make sure that there's a good scientific basis for the work that's done by the Air Board, by the State Water Resources Control Board. They also implement Prop 65. So if you pick up a product that says this product is a product known to the state of California to contain a chemical that is a reproductive toxin, then that's because that has been identified by the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessments. And as I said, they also review the programs and the work done by other agencies. And they don't have an axe to grind. They're there to just make sure that there's a scientific basis for the decisions that are made by those agencies. Tonight, we're fortunate to have with us the director of the office, Dr. Lauren Zeiss. We also have Dr. Melanie Marty, who is a deputy director at the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessments. And we also have Dr. Boudreau, who is here. And he's a division or a branch chief, and he specializes in dealing with air issues. They've done an analysis just recently of the air data that we have had available to us concerning this particular gas leak, and they'll be continuing to look at this, the air effects as time goes on. Under the governor's proclamation, they will continue to work with the agencies to assess the health impacts of these emissions. And importantly, they've been asked to set up a panel of experts to take a look at the health impacts. And that panel, the direction came out earlier this month, but today the announcement went out on the doctors that will be part of that panel and the experts that will be part of that panel, so we can get started as quickly as possible to look at the health impact. So that's an overly long preview, but I wanted to let you know where CalEPA, the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessments, and the Air Resources Board fit into tonight's program, and we'll look forward to hearing your questions. Thank you.
Okay, well, so now's the part of the presentation where we want to start to hear from you. And let me just start off by saying, you know, we understand how serious this is. The governor understands how serious this is. We definitely want to hear from you. I want this to be an opportunity to get information. There's going to be microphones that are be going out here. If we're hearing multiple of the same kind of questions, just to keep the dialogue moving on through the night, we'll make a point of that. As you ask questions, I will present the microphone to the most appropriate or the number of different people who have information to share with you to be able to answer your question. And we'll see how it goes the rest of the evening. And so with that, let me just offer, if you'd like to stand up and ask the question, please come to a microphone and we'll begin. Good lineup. Okay. With that, sir, we'll start with you.
I'm George O'Connor, Porter Ranch.
Yeah. Okay.
SoCal Gas has given me filters for my house, charcoal filters, to filter the air. Will that take the chemicals that are in the air out of my house?
Okay, it's a good question. Air Resources Board, be the most appropriate person to answer. We're gonna have the Executive Officer of the Air Resources Board.
Yes, thank you. What we've done is we've looked at a range of air filters and looked at the effectiveness of air filters and identified those for Southern California Gas, calling out, and we put this information on our website, those that are most effective at capturing the organics, mercaptans, H2S, other substances that we're talking about. We're also, in fact, this didn't happen today, it's happening early next week, are including recommendations on the frequency at which those filters need to be replaced. So in other words, you have the base piece of equipment, but then they have material in them that captures the organics. Those need to be replaced periodically. Those two activities couple with one another, recommendations on the filters that are most effective, recommendations on a number of filters. In other words, depending on the volume of the house, and if it's one or two stories, two filters or more, it requires two, and the frequency at which those adsorbents need to be replaced are the counsel that we're providing, and we're putting that out for the public to see, and are providing the associated documentation on the best equipment out there.
So I mean, is that a yes or a no?
My characterization is we're confident those filters work and capture the material. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Ma'am? Ma'am?
Yes.
Oh, sir? Sorry.
The
lights are.
No problem. Follow up on that. Follow up on that one. I understand these are gas, they're electrostatic filters. Those filters are good for capturing particulate matter, like small particulate matter, not methane. So I really wonder about that. The filters you're installing are for particulate, and this is a gas. It's a carbon gas. How does a particulate filter work on a carbon gas? So that's my first question. The real
okay. Hold on, Richard.
Then I just want to add my other one. Then
okay.
I'll sit down.
Okay.
The other one is, I understood when this first started, you established a zip code and said, this is the zip code we're interested in. I used to work in the oil and gas industry. How come you did not do dispersion, air dispersion modeling to see where this gas could go? How far it could go? Where is it going?
Okay, thank you for the question.
With respect to the question about a particulate filter versus one that captures organics, the filters that we're identified and identified on our site are to capture organics. They have a specific adsorbent that is intended to capture organics, and we confirmed the effectiveness of those filters at capturing specific organic chemicals. So the in addition to the filtration of particles, the mechanics of those filters is to capture and hold organics.
About the question on the zip code on air monitoring?
I got to get more background on that particular question.
Okay. So we'll put that in the parking lot. We'll come back to it or be able to follow back up.
Specifically, it's not about monitoring. It's about dispersion modeling.
Modeling, yes.
Modeling.
Got you. Okay. This side, sir?
I have three questions.
Okay.
I live in 91344 zip code, Granada Hills. Should I worry about the air condition?
Okay, his first question has to do with Granada Hills and the air atmosphere in Granada Hills. Do you know that one? Okay. Ma'am?
So.
Lauren? Hello? Hold on.
We have.
Hi. We have measurements taken in Porter Ranch of different chemicals that we have looked at. And compared to health values that we are pretty certain would not cause an effect, in those comparisons, we are currently below any levels of benzene in particular and some of the other air toxics that we would anticipate any health effects. Whether the concentrations in your area are identical, I can't answer that question.
Who can answer?
Anything, Richard? Okay. All right.
I think what we can do is take a look at your area, take a look at the distance from the site, and get back to you on that. And what we're trying to do at OEHA as we make findings is to put them on our website. So you can get at our website through the general OES website, but we will be looking at the different locations and considering the extent to which the chemicals that are emitted disperse to them.
I think I should add also that we have a technical panel of experts, and a couple of those experts are in exposure assessment. So we will be looking more at how these chemicals have moved through the air.
Okay. Second question, sir.
Okay, who do I talk to if I have a system and a suggestion to cap the leak? Who do I talk to?
After the event, you can come up and talk to us. I'll be happy.
I need to talk to one or two particular people who are interested in that area.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so that would be the Division of Oil, Gas, Geothermal Resources, Jason Marshall, two to my left. And so Jason is here tonight, but he is also up in Sacramento.
I'd like to talk to you if you don't mind. Third question, BP oil leak in Louisiana area, it cost billions, and BP came up with the financial no problem. There was a talk here that there might be tracking expenses and potential penalties and all that. Now, is there a chance that the gas company can go bankrupt and just walk away from it?
Michael?
I don't think so.
Good.
But let's wait a while before we start to be sure about that.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Sir.
Thank you. With respect to our elected officials, is this okay?
Yes.
With respect to our elected officials who are here tonight, who spoke about never again and what happens after the leak stops, I think the issue for most of us, Senator and Assemblyman and Councilman, is now. The only person who spoke with the word urgency was Secretary Laird. So the question for our elected officials is, what are you doing now? Legislation down the road doesn't help us. Sound bites and photo ops in front of the Aliso Canyon facility don't help us. What are you doing now to help us? For example, what are you doing about diminution in house values? What are you doing about those of us that are still paying gas bills to the people that are poisoning us? What are you doing about, I'll finish my questions and I'd like to hear your answer, Councilman. What are you doing about our neighborhoods where our kids can't go out and play in the park? I was talking to my wife today. She's afraid to go take a walk for fear of being poisoned.
Okay, let's let him respond to your question.
What are our elected officials doing?
No, those are the questions that should be asked. Absolutely, and I appreciate you asking them. Because one of the things I didn't want to get up here today is just rattle off and say, let me tell you every single thing that I'm doing and my staff is doing every single day. For those of you that don't know, let me just tell you a little short laundry list. First of all, I live here. So I'm going through and experiencing the same thing that many of you are. More importantly, every single day, we start the day at 5:30 in the morning. We get on the phone, and I'm not going to walk you through every day. We get on the phone with a conference call. My entire staff and team is both on a call with SoCalGas throughout the day, as well as a lot of the regulatory agencies. More importantly, what we did first and early on is I set up a community advisory committee that, if you're not familiar with, how many people are familiar with the Porter Ranch Community Advisory Committee that we've established? Okay, a few of you. So what we did is I appointed members of this community from Porter Ranch, Northridge, Granada Hills, West Hills, to all to get together with the HOAs and Save Porter Ranch. It's live stream on the internet with the gas company because no information was coming out. The information that was coming out not only was sparse, but it wasn't believable. And I think to this day, it's still not. It seems like it's one step forward and two steps backwards. The most important thing is making sure we get information and disseminate the information and get this closed as soon as possible and restore what this community is. There's no question. So it's not the rhetoric, and it's not never again. The first thing I did is I went up to the site, and I met with everybody there and said, what are you doing to getting information out? What, you set up a 404 number. I'm not even sure what state that is. We don't need a local phone number and a table on Cessnon. We need a storefront where people can actually show up to get relocation information. So I put together a hearing. I negotiated the lease at the Porter Ranch Shopping Center. I brought them there, got it open. We have two sites now. We opened up our office, and then we filed a lawsuit with the city attorney on behalf of all of you to make sure that they would follow through to get you reimbursements, full relocation, make sure those, not only the elderly and the disabled and those with special needs, had special treatment immediately, but to speed that up, they had 2 relocation companies, they now have 17. On top of that, and there's a long laundry list that's on my website without rattling off all of those things, the most important thing is this. I'm working very, very closely every single day with every single member of the community here, as my staff is. We have been on the phone every day. Our office, we opened up our office to depositions, in fact, where we brought a team of city attorneys down to the office to call everybody in and say, if you would like to join this, not our lawsuit, because there, I think there's enough lawyers out there spreading enough fear and uncertainty and doubt as well, and they're doing a good job at that, but to actually file one on behalf of the people of California to hold them accountable and make sure they get this stopped immediately. We've been successful in getting those implemented and stipulated orders to make sure that those things can be done. I've attended every single town hall that they've had here, not only the ones that have been put on by regulatory agencies, but I've shown up to every single event. So I've done a lot, but let me also say I've worked very closely with our state legislators, Scott Wilk, who's here, our Congressman Steve Knight, who's on his way here back from Washington. In fact, he's here now. Just flew in. I was on the phone with him right when he landed from LAX to come here tonight. We get on the phone every single day and talk, and our staffs talk every day, as well as his staff with Dante Acosta, who's here, Senator Fran Pavley's office. But outside of the rhetoric, I think the most important thing is this. Shut it down and make it safe.
I'd like to follow up.
Quickly.
Councilman, I appreciate the shut it down mentality, but that's exactly what I'm talking about. Lawsuits, as everyone in this room knows, are going to take years. Nothing's happening now. What is happening right this minute to make us whole?
Yes.
Two specific things that I'll mention without going through everything. One thing that we've been able to do in the last month is to make sure no new gas is coming into the reservoir. So the pressure in the reservoir has dropped down substantially, which has reduced the emissions. It's not the final solution, obviously, but it did stop the emissions from increasing. The moratorium, the bill that I am carrying, and we've been in session 1 week, you have to realize this, and it's an urgency item, which means it could be passed within the next few weeks and on the governor's desk, would say unless and until these key agencies and independent reviewer can prove that you can put in additional volumes of gas in that reservoir and make sure it's safe so that we won't have another leak again, no more gas goes in there. So the long-term solutions will be taken care of afterwards, but the first priority, stopping the leak, and then making sure that we investigate all these older wells, especially those that predate 1953, and if they are not safe enough with their pipes and their 7-inch integrity of their well casings, then they should not be allowed to continue. So our office and the legislature is fully engaged now. You have our intention. We are paying very close attention to doing everything we can, in addition to providing oversight over the agencies, which is our job.
And I would add that the governor's emergency proclamation bolsters what Senator Pavley is doing. And so a moratorium is in place now. That no new gas will be injected into Aliso Canyon until the regulators actually complete a comprehensive safety review with independent expertise to demonstrate that it is safe, and independent experts validate that the air quality in the surrounding community is safe. There's an open question, and obviously there's a lot of folks in here that want Aliso Canyon shut down. And that's one. Raise your hand if you're just to get a show of hands. Okay. So that's one clear sentiment that we're taking back to Sacramento is the intensity of your advocacy on that. Toward that end, the governor has directed a lot of the people up here to come together to assess the future viability of Aliso Canyon and other gas storage fields in the state. The fact is, President Picker has explained that these gas storage fields can't disappear overnight, or there would be impacts to actually heating our homes, turning on the lights, et cetera. But the state is committed to actually understanding what should be the future of Aliso Canyon, what should be the future of these storage wells. Is it feasible to shut Aliso Canyon down? Is it feasible to shut other gas storage fields down? And as the governor and I think Mark told the neighborhood council, we're very open-minded. All options are on the table, but it needs to be fact-based, and that's what that report will provide.
Thank you, Wade. Thank you. Ma'am?
Yes, thank you very much. I wanted to first say that I've been a member of the Porter Ranch community for over 35 years, moved my family into the area. Beautiful area, clean, fresh air, blue skies, sheep grazed along Tampa Boulevard. And by the way, when we bought our homes in the area, there was never any disclosures about the Southern California Gas Company. This was true not just 35 years ago, but also even in the last few years. No one knew about it. I literally found out that the largest natural gas reservoir in the western United States was literally in my backyard. I never knew about it at all. Today, by the way, we have to disclose if we attempt to sell our houses, and we have to tell about the gas leak, and we have to tell that people are becoming nauseous and sick and nosebleeds. It's actually in the disclosures today. That's unbelievably startling. We live in earthquake country. You've heard of the Northridge earthquake. However, was there the largest reservoir of natural gas in the western United States right at the epicenter of a major earthquake? We live in a fire area, which my understanding, which I just found out a little less than a year ago, that the Southern California Gas Company actually was the perpetrator of one of the largest fires that we had up here, the Cessnon fire. So this is my question. Who issues the permit? Who made the decision to give the permit to the Southern California Gas Company? What type of safety check was done on 115 wells before issuing the permit? Is there a 20-year renewal about to come up for the Southern California Gas Company and the Aliso Canyon Reservoir? You're shaking your head. That's what we've heard, so you'll let us know. What type of regulations are there or should have been? How close can a massive 84 billion cubic feet of natural gas be to homes, residents, schools? 150 wells with corrosive pipes, old oil wells not properly encased, not properly prepared for natural gas storage. I saw in the LA Times today, I was absolutely shocked to read the article. Have you all seen the article? I have it with me. They said that whatever the Southern California Gas Company has done so far, that they've actually made it worse, that they've actually broken into more area of the hillsides, and that it's becoming more and more dangerous. So you get a copy of it, I have it with me. I personally cannot see any other solution, and I understand how difficult it is, and I know it will take time, but it cannot remain here any longer, not with this many homes and this many people. And for the We know that it's going to take a great deal of planning, and I know my time is up, but it'll take a great deal of planning to try to find another area, but it needs to be in an area that's not inhabited by human beings. This does not work any longer. So I guess the main question maybe to PUC is what's happening with the renewal of it? Because we've heard that the 20-year renewal is coming up very soon.
Thank you.
I don't believe that there is a 20-year renewable, but I will check and I'll make sure that it gets on the website so that you can see.
Okay,
but I don't believe that there is a 20-year renewal.
Okay, is there any renewal coming up of the lease?
Not that I know of. I could.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going to introduce the okay. Director of the Safety and Enforcement Division, okay. Aliso Canyon.
Okay.
But I'll just say that we don't generally issue a permit with a term for it.
The reason I'm asking you is that when I was at the meeting a couple of days ago, someone representing Supervisor Antonovich, I asked, are the Board of Supervisors in charge of the permits to continue leasing the land? And they said, no, it was the PUC. So that's why I was asking you.
Thank you very much for your question. I'm Aliso Canyon. I'm the director of the Safety and Enforcement Division. I'm going to speculate a little bit, which I'm not supposed to do, but to try and answer your question. The original permit to SoCal Gas was issued in the 70s. When these types of permits are issued, they don't have a sunset date. But as Southern California Gas Company makes improvements or any changes to the facilities, they apply for modifications that basically extends the permit. So we've had one of those applications for which the work is still ongoing. So that's one area where some of the confusion may have come from. And then we also every 4 years have what's called rate cases where the company comes in and asks for more money. We are currently considering one of those rate cases at the commission. So again, that could have been another sort of case that we have that could have introduced that notion, but to both of our knowledge, there is no such thing as those permits that have a 20-year expiration, so it's probably one of those cases that somebody was referring to.
I can answer that question about what she's referring to.
Thank you.
She's probably referring to, my name is Matt Pacuco from Save Porter Ranch. DWP and the City of LA are quietly negotiating another 20-year renewal of SoCal Gas, providing gas to the DWP for power. I believe that's the 20 years that she's talking about.
Got it.
Okay. Franchise agreement.
Okay. Thanks.
Yes, Secretary Gilarducci, yes, if I could respond to the question with regard to the wells. There's two things that I would respond to, ma'am. First off, I completely understand the concern. The wells in Aliso Canyon are subject to annual inspections. Many of those wells are vintage wells. It's well known that some of them were built in the 1950s. Those inspection standards, by emergency regulations that we issued today, those inspection standards are going to be upgraded, and I think it's self-evident why we need to make sure we do that. But with regard to your question about the LA Times article, the article stopped short of making one important point, and that is that each time that the well control has been attempted, there were 7 attempts, the most recent one being on December 22nd, the well has been resecured. And indeed, today the well has been resecured. The wellhead has been resecured. It is cabled in place and anchored by cement. The securing is to make sure that it does not wobble. And the wellhead is competent and it is holding pressure. So the well is stable today, and it's going to, we believe, stay that way because we have indicated that we will not be interested in seeing, and I don't believe that SoCal Gas is either, but we have said to them, we don't want you to make any more attempts to kill the well from the top down. That is the source of potential damage. We are looking to the relief well as the means to control that well. And we're hopeful that when they do the intercept on February 10th, that is their schedule, and then they begin the pumping operations, that will be successful. But that is the state of play today. The wellhead is stable, and we think it's going to stay that way until we get to the place where the well is controlled completely.
Thank you. Sir.
Yeah, hello. I grew up in this area. I hiked and hunted and rode dirt bikes up in these hills long before there were houses. And there's been smells emanating from those hills for years and years. And my question is, as we know about the catastrophic event on October 23rd, what hasn't SoCal Gas revealed to us as the homeowners and people who live in the area that's happened maybe many months or many years before that? You know, we've all heard that there's 100, 119, 190 wells honeycombed throughout that Santa Susana mountain range. But every damn one needs to be checked. Every one of them needs to be checked, not just the one that blew catastrophically. So we have the peace of mind to know, and if they were leaking, we want to know for how long and where. Because this isn't a new problem. It's certainly a new crisis, but it's not a new problem. Thank you.
Thank you. Jason, you are up.
Sir, I completely understand that point of view. We have, at the direction of the governor, and it's obviously a sentiment that's shared in the legislature, at least by Senator Pavley, and I'm certain many others, the plan to test every single one of the wells in Aliso Canyon. There are 115 of them, and before any of those wells are put back on injection, we will have a testing protocol established, and that those wells will need to pass it to make sure that they are competent and able to withstand pressures.
Great. Thank you. Sir.
Are the results going to be transparent?
Absolutely. Not only will the results be transparent, but
they will post them on their website, which you're going to get through Department of Conservation's website, or go to the website we've referenced tonight through OES, and that's where all the material is coming for a one-stop click. So you will have that information. Sir. Okay. Ma'am, we have to wait till you get up to the microphone and hold that thought, because we want to hear from you. Sir.
Hi. My name is Murray Rosansky from Chatsworth. I want to suggest that there's a practical near-term way to capture a significant amount of the leaking gas and turn it into hot air and electricity, and they're called gas turbine generator sets. There are aircraft-based gas turbine generators that fit in containers and are portable, and the front end of them is basically a 100,000 horsepower vacuum cleaner, and they love running on natural gas. So instead of seeing this huge plume coming up, which keyed me on this idea because it's concentrated, a group of these gas turbine generator sets with the intakes aimed at the leak would pull in a significant amount of the gas and again turn it into hot air and electricity. And why that hasn't been tried, I don't know.
Thank you. Who, you guys want to speak to that?
Jason, in a couple of sentences, do you want to explain that? So SoCal Gas right now is planning this gas capture equipment that they're going to put over where the area that's leaking. And the idea is to get the gas and then to get rid of the gas. And if that's successful, it means the methanes and the odorants that are coming in the community stop. So what, you know, we get asked the question, what's the big deal? Why can't they just do that? And so the gentleman had one suggestion. Can you just talk to the challenge, or what's the difficulty?
I believe so. I can, Wade. The gas capture system that's under discussion right now has both an incinerator component, which is under consideration for permit by the South Coast Air Quality Management District, but there is also the challenge of actually capturing the gas at the surface. We understand that SoCal Gas is presently preparing some notions of how to pull that out of the ground, but there are considerations that have to be had that have to do with what the The explosive limits are of natural gas. This notion that you've mentioned, sir, I think that we, and this notion that you mentioned, sir, I'm certain that that we would like to hear it. I'm sure that the air quality folks would also like to hear it. We'd be happy to pass that along to SoCalGas. We are very interested in finding a way to capture that methane.
Maybe you can, after the, tonight, come and speak to Jason and give him a little more information. Thank you very much. Sir.
My name is Rich Feldman. I'm from Chatsworth. My first question is, what will you do to stop Southern California Gas from following every other utility whenever they have a problem and jacking their rates sky high?
That one's for President Picker.
We're in the midst of looking at all the things that they do from all over their service area for gas and what their expenses are. Some of those expenses, I think we'd all agree, are a pretty good idea. We want them to go through and continue to look at weak spots in their system and make sure that their gas pipelines are as safe as they can conceivably be. We want them to have an adequate workforce to continue to look for problems to safely operate the system. We want them to actually be able to get a reliable supply of gas, both for home heating and cooking, but also for electricity. So we look at all those expenses, we look at their costs, we try to figure out the different classes of customers and what a fair share is. I'm not sure that this is going to dominate that cost. I think that their gas pipeline replacement and operations and maintenance is a bigger cost in the system. However, I think that, that if you're interested, we can make sure that their proceeding is actually posted on the OES website so you can look at it for yourself. And then we'll be happy to make sure you get updates along the way.
You may have answered.
Hold on, there's one more follow-up to that.
Hi, I just wanted to add that we actually sent a letter to SoCalGas directing them to provide us the detailed cost information, and they're submitting that information to on the 15th of the month. So the first submittal is today, and we will be posting that on the website, on the PUC website. You can go directly there or go through the Cal OES so that the cost information will be transparent for everybody.
But Lisa and Michael, it's not a given that ratepayers are going to be asked to pay for the response cost. That's actually will be an active discussion at the CPUC.
Two different pools of money. One is what goes into rates and the costs that we're tracking for actions here. That's separate. They're going to have to come back to justify to us that should actually go to ratepayers. That's going to be after we investigate both what happened and who's responsible.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Follow-up question, sir?
He may have answered my second question. I don't use Facebook. I don't have a smartphone. I'm known as a dinosaur.
God bless you on that.
How would you get information to me? And it seems you do have direct websites. That's good. Thank you. And last one. I heard today the expression blowout, which doesn't sound like a really good thing to happen. What's going on?
Okay. Jason.
If I may, the term blowout is quite expressive. I understand that. A blowout generally would refer to a loss of wellhead control, which is to say, without getting too technically geeky, the top of the well that keeps the pressure in place. If it stops keeping that pressure in place, that's a blowout. Right now, the top of the well at SS25 is keeping the pressure in place, and we've secured the well, SoCalGas has secured the well, and so we don't think that that's something that's imminent.
Amen.
Sorry to butt in, but I'm not an expert, so I want to try to explain this, but you know, the leaking well, the SS25 well, is capped at the top. So it's not that there's a hole in the top of the well and it's streaming out. The leak is about 500 feet down. And so the issue is, because you know these attempts have pushed materials down and it's come back up, it's made the ground unstable around the wellhead. And it's required this anchoring that Jason talked about. The concern is, if they kept on doing that and it got so unstable, then the wellhead could lose control and the top of the well could open, and that would be a lot more methane. So that's what everybody wants to avoid, and that's what would be called a blowout. In this case, you know, the division has been very clear over the past weeks that that wellhead needs to be anchored and double anchored and triple anchored to make sure that that wellhead doesn't open.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Ma'am?
Hi, my name is Roberta, and I have a totally different question. Why are you only worrying about the people who are leaving? What about the people that are staying in their homes? No one gives a hoot about us. They're slow in coming to do the weather stripping. They're slow in putting the filtering. They're not offering us anything, but you're offering the world to the people that are going away.
Did you want to comment on that at all?
Yeah, I'll take a crack at that. So, two things. I got the question, and I hear your concern as well. So, first, in answering that question, I think you should all know as well, and I'm answering this on the city of Los Angeles is actually not relocating anybody. In fact, this facility is not even in the city of LA. But having said that, what we've done is we've gone after SoCal Gas to actually do the weather stripping, to speed that up and hire additional contractors. We took them to court over this as well on your behalf to make sure that they were doing that and stepping those efforts up. The air filtration systems that they're installing now was one of the things that we mandated early on to say not everybody is going to be leaving their home. And in fact, even if you've left your home and relocated, you can still sign up for the air filtration systems and weather stripping. But for the ones that are here, those are the things that are being done by SoCal Gas, not a government agency, but SoCal Gas, and they're doing so because they've entered into also the stipulated order by the courts.
But you're paying these people to live in another place $5,000, $8,000, $9,000. You're finding home. Why don't you reimburse us for staying in our home?
A couple other things they're doing.
Giving anything to us.
Right.
Not a penny.
So a couple other things. First of all, again, let me just be crystal clear. It's SoCal Gas. It's not the city of LA who's paying anybody to do anything. But having said that, if you actually also, we've asked a couple things. It was getting very complicated for those who have moved out. Let me just focus on that for 1 second. They had different per diems for meals. If you were over 18, you got $45. If you were under 18, you got $35. If you were under 10, that's all gone. You had to save all your receipts. That's all gone. You just get now a reimbursement, so you don't have to be a CPA overnight and document and save everything. That's all gone. For the ones that are staying in their homes, SoCal Gas doesn't provide any compensation to either if you've left the home or staying in the home. They're simply covering the out-of-cost and the out-of-pocket cost. The people that have been relocated still have to pay a mortgage. The people that have been relocated still have to pay their property taxes, and in fact, we put in a motion to lower your property taxes for everybody. So we're working with the county assessor on that. That's for everybody. The people who have been relocated still have to pay their trash pickup. We've put in a motion, and we're working very closely with Public Works, to not have a fee to pick up your trash because you're not even taking it out. So those are the things we are working on.
Money.
So appreciate that.
I don't care what you say.
Yeah. Okay.
They are making money. I'll keep saying.
However, I agree 100%.
Take care of us, the ones
yes,
who are
ma'am.
Staying in our homes.
Absolutely.
You're not concerned about us.
Great. Thank you.
One iota.
Yeah. I totally agree. Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Sir.
Yes. my name is James Ripley from Sylmar, and. You probably, I saw in the news yesterday that there was a massive leak, okay? To me, it's a massive overflow. A leak is something that drips. This is not dripping. So the reason I'm here from Sylmar is I'd like to know what everyone's doing as far as assurances and inspections to let the surrounding zip codes such as Chatsworth, Granada Hills, Northridge, where they've changed the kids and they sent them to the schools in Northridge. They may be still breathing it, I don't know. But all these areas, how are they being communicated to?
one person said something about online. Well, contrary to popular belief, there's still a lot of people who don't use laptops and so forth and so on. So are there mailings that are going out with assurances as to what it is in that neighborhood? And has anyone checked the neighborhoods? I'd like to know if anyone checked the neighborhoods. And that's my question.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, it kind of relates to the question from Granada Hills earlier, which is what's the geographical range of the air quality data collection? Because we obviously talk a lot about Porter Ranch because Porter Ranch is on the front lines. But the point is, if you're living in an adjacent community, you may be impacted as well. And so I think nobody sitting up here actually has the specific locations in front of them of the air data, quality air collection locations. But if those locations aren't broad enough into adjacent communities, we will make a commitment tonight to make sure that the air quality collecting happens in these communities. I actually think it isn't to some degree, but one thing that one of our agencies is doing is measuring it hourly and actually putting that online. And so we'll make sure that it's geographically broad. To your question of, you know, what happens if you're not online and what amount of mailings, sort of snail mail, the state, I don't think, is doing any snail mail to date. So that's good feedback. And I can't speak for SoCalGas.
Thank you, Wayne. Okay, sir?
Understand that the benzene, and that's what really brought me over here. The benzene is like 18 parts per billion. And if you breathe that one time, that's all you should ever take a whiff of one time. And if it's 14 times that amount now, how far is that blowing? Is it going to Santa Clarita? Is it where? That's my question.
Who's go, ma'am?
So the highest grab sample that we saw was about 5 parts per billion. But if you look over time at all the grab samples, they average less than a part per billion. We have some data from the South Coast Air Quality Management District that took 24-hour continuous samples. Those were around a tenth to two-tenths part per billion. So those levels we don't think would cause an adverse health effect for benzene. The mercaptans, the symptoms we're hearing about the mercaptans make sense to me because our nose is the best detector. There's better than an instrument at detecting the sulfur-containing compounds. And they do give you headaches. You respond to the noxious odor with headaches and nausea. That's real, for sure. The benzene, though, we just don't think there's an issue with benzene.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Sir?
My name is Marco Maldonado, and I have some questions to different agencies, starting with CPUC. In addition to the question that the gentleman was asking in terms of the rate increase and how you guys are going to quantify that and then making sure that this cost does not get passed on to the ratepayers, I believe there's an article that says states that you guys were aware that the gas company knew of how the pipes were corroding and how some of them were already leaking and compromised. And that's the whole reason why, also in addition to the normal rate increase, they were requesting this rate increase. So how are you going to differentiate that cost increase this coming up February, which we're supposed to attend to as well, and then continue to increase based on you guys knowing the fact that this facility was deteriorating versus now that it's in compromise and there's additional cost to that? How are you going to differentiate that so that the cost doesn't get passed on to us?
Hi. Okay. I'm going to try my best to explain this. So to the first question about the fact that an issue was reported to the California Public Utilities Commission, the filing that SoCalGas made where it's referring to their concern with that they need to do more maintenance on the wells. It was done in the context of a rate filing where they were asking for future costs going forward after 2016. So it basically starting with this year, and that decision hasn't been made yet. That is still pending in front of the commission. And because it is a rate-based filing, it isn't a notification of a safety issue. So that information is also being shared with Dogger, and it's really the Department of Geothermal Resources and Gas that is doing that review, and it's their ongoing monitoring. So to the question of how the cost aspect is going to be looked at, the current cost that SoCalGas is spending, they can't really spend more than they've already been authorized at this point. So as President Picker was saying earlier, anything that they're incurring over and above what they were already authorized is going to go through an additional review. So there is no way for SoCalGas to really spend anything on this issue and then hide the ball. We're going to be watching that very closely, and there's going to be a separate case to look just at that.
I'll try to distill it down. They asked us a while ago for permission to spend money to upgrade wells and to go back to some of the wells that...
Did you say some of the leaked wells?
Excuse me?
You said some of the leaked wells, right?
No. I don't think I said deep wells, but they have to ask us for permission to expend ratepayer dollars. They have to give us an amount. We have to approve it. They have previously asked for dollars to go back and fix wells. They are spending some of that money. In the course of that, all this came to light. They found the leak. They've been working on it. The costs that they have for this specific well are being tracked separately. They can't charge that to ratepayers in this upcoming rate case. They're going to have to come to us with a special request, or it's going to probably get caught up in whatever kinds of enforcement actions get taken place. That's why we're tracking it separately.
So then my question is, when you say that they're requesting additional costs to repair wells, and that notion of repairs, are they letting you know in the report that there are leaks and wells are compromised? So in other words, are we paying for their repairs,
or should they be paying for their own repairs? I don't know if repairs is the word, because we are not well experts, but this was an old gas and oil extraction field. There's been gas there and oil there for millions of years. And after the companies who were taking gas, Chevron, Tidelands, a number of other gas companies left it, they came and asked to be able to use it for gas storage. There are something like 200 wells there. They're only using 110. They have to go, and the word that
just to keep my question simple, if there are repairs needed, are we paying for those repairs, or should they be paying for
always
their own
repairs needed? This is big infrastructure. Somebody is always repairing gas pipelines, gas compressors, gas meters. They're always repairing stuff.
They just can't answer.
If you have a gas meter at your house, sooner or later somebody's going to come and replace it or repair it. If you have gas pipelines that come into your house and you ever have a leak, somebody comes and repairs it and replaces it. That's a fact of life.
So in other words, it's safe to say, President Picker, that part of their ongoing rates go into ongoing maintenance and repair work. I think that's what he's trying to say. So,
But I understand there's normal wear and tear.
Right.
The cost to the operations when somebody actually buys something new, and then you have depreciation and wear and tear. But when you know you're going into a business and things already broken, and then you're going to ask somebody else to fix something that you're already buying that's broken because they already disclosed, hey, these items are leaking. Let me go ahead and increase my rate so I can repair the infrastructure that's already leaking.
I'm going to have to defer to the Division of Oil, Gas, and Geothermal Resources to tell you what's the normal lifespan of a well, because they don't last forever.
That's correct.
I think
okay,
to answer
let's keep it together. So
So I hope this point of clarification helps. The wells in question that I believe are the subject of what is referred to as the SIMP, the Storage Integrity Management Plan that SoCalGas has proposed, those wells were not leaking at the time. And so this discussion about deferred maintenance is one that is relevant. The discussion, I believe, Chairman Picker indicated is that with regard to recovery from the well that is leaking, SS25, that would have to be handled separately under PUC petition. But the important distinction, I believe, is that at the time that SoCalGas made that presentation, the wells were not leaking. Now, we have a testing protocol that we have in place for the wells. It is a protocol that looks to see if the wells are leaking at the time of the test. One of the things that is going to come about as a part of the new regulations, the emergency regulations that have been released, and that will be part of the evaluation of all of the wells in Aliso Canyon, is the notion not just of is the well leaking now, but does the well have a potential to leak in the near future? And then let's talk about what orders need to be made to ensure that those wells do have integrity. I hope that clarifies the issue.
No, it doesn't, because you haven't still answered to me if the cost is still going to be passed on to us. Let me ask one more. My question is fracking going on?
Jason, his question
sorry,
is fracking. Okay, but he did ask, there is a relevant question here, which is fracking happening at Aliso Canyon or has it happened at Aliso Canyon?
Hydraulic fracturing has been used in Aliso Canyon. Our review of the well records indicates that it was used 7 times. It was not used, according to the well records, on SS25, which is the leaking well, or on any of the wells within approximately 1,500 feet of that. That is based upon a review of our well records. Many of you who know the history of hydraulic fracturing know that that was not an activity that was required to be reported to the department prior to January 1 of 2014. And we're going to be making sure that we get the information in the older well records from the operator. That is part of a letter and a directive that went out today from Oil and Gas Supervisor Ken Harris.
So I live in that neighborhood. How do we get notified this fracking is going on?
Presently, under the rules propagated by Senator Pavley, Senate Bill 4, public notice has to be provided of hydraulic fracturing to people within a specified distance of the well, and it has to be posted publicly on the Department of Conservation's website.
And so directly, there is a sort of a follow-up that the division made to SoCalGas that says, okay, this is what our records say, but we want to double confirm, give us the rest, you know, any records that haven't been provided about fracking. And we will put those, you know, that's public information that gets put up on the website.
In addition to this,
the public one, can we?
Well, no, because I mean, I said I had three sections to ask.
Well, I think we're going to have to move on. We have a lot of people waiting. You can come up to us afterwards, and we can address that.
Maybe if you have questions for me, I'll hang out afterwards.
No, mine was for the air quality section, because I asked before about the amount of testing that was done in terms of the data. And I know that AQMD has been doing monitoring off-site, but how much monitoring on-site on the well near the wellhead has been done? Because I read a report on AQMD that they did collect 3 canisters, 2 of them which are pulled by Boots and Coots, one of them by the gas company, and that's how the data was collected on-site of the well. If we had more data, more real time, we would know exactly what's coming out of the well, and we can actually kind of model the dispersion or exactly know where or how much is coming out of there in terms of the actual benzene, instead of actually measuring spotted little areas where the air can disperse them anywhere, and it can actually be at a lower volume. So at least we know exactly.
Let's get a chance to answer the question on air monitoring. Richard?
The monitoring that's going on, you're correct. We're not, ARB's not doing monitoring up at the site itself. We're doing monitoring in the community, and we put that on the website so people can see it in the community for methane. We recently added benzene. You can go real time. This is for anyone to see. It's posted on the site hourly by hourly measurements. We're looking to add, in fact, I directed my folks, add additional benzene monitoring. We're also doing flyovers at the site. in terms of flying through the plume that's helping us estimate the emission rate. And we also have some downwind fixed monitors. So we're looking at all these monitoring elements and making that data available. But if the point is, and we're open to this, if the point is, hey, we've looked at that, we still have some concerns about the need for additional measurements, I'm open to talk about that. But what we tried to do is get information out to all of you, have you have real access to it, hourly by hourly measurements, so you can see what's going on in the community, as well as the flyover information. All this information's posted.
So the flyover is happening even though we have a no-fly zone?
Yeah. The flyover is outside of the fly zone. It's about 3,000. We run from elevation to about 3,000 to 30,000 feet, and it flies right through the methane plume.
Thank you. Sir?
Yeah, hi. I'm Jeff Naftel. I'm also a Porter Ranch resident. I got a few questions. You know, as a layperson, I'm having a hard time understanding why, when the gas company had reported that this was predictable, what's happening to us, that as a collective group up here to protect us, that you stood by and didn't force them to cap those wells or put the those valves on, whatever they needed to put on there, that this was, they told you that this could happen. So why did you let it happen?
So can you clarify your question for us?
Well, it's really, I'm trying to understand why, when you were notified that that they have a problem, they told you they had a problem, and that what was happening to us now here with this well leakage was predictable, that it was going to be a problem, and we knew it, and that I understand a number like $300 million was floated out there. Why didn't you require Sempra to come in and take care of the problem instead of having the disaster that we're dealing with now? Aside from property value problems, I don't know how that's going to be resolved. These lawsuits, it's going to be a $1 billion action when it's all done.
Maybe I'll try to turn that into a question for the CPUC, which is when SoCalGas, you know, testified before the CPUC to get more funding for upgrades, what was the reaction of the CPUC? And I think the gentleman suggesting that, you know, that was an indication that, you know, something like this could happen. My understanding is that the CPUC actually approved the request to actually spend the money that they were requesting to upgrade. That's not going to make you satisfied, because I think your point is more should have been done from your perspective. But I do think in this case, when SoCalGas came to the CPUC and said, these are old wells, we need to upgrade them, we need this amount of money, the CPUC approved it.
These things aren't really brought to us as problems. They're normally brought to us as, here's our pipeline or our well replacement program. This is infrastructure maintenance and replacement of aging parts. We look at that to make sure that it's warranted, and we approve the costs. Now, I will say that we don't understand wells very well. We mostly do gas pipelines. And so here, perhaps we need to have the guidance that the Dogger is actually starting to provide us. But so far as our experts could tell, this was actually just normal maintenance and replacement of aging parts.
Okay. Is there a follow-up question?
Yeah, my last portion of this was, considering the financial loss that we're going to be looking at potentially here, what is the state going to be doing here to assure us that Sempra is going to stand by and pay these claims, and it's going to be huge?
Well, I can tell you that the Attorney General, which is sort of the equivalent of the city attorney for the state, you know, is actively exploring whether violations took place. The CPUC is doing an investigation. The Division of Oil and Gas is doing an investigation. And there's any number of penalties or sanctions that could take place. I don't think they're going to give you a satisfying answer now, because a lot of this depends on, once the well is closed, actually understanding the cause of the leak and then doing a much deeper dive on the company's response to the leak. But I think, well, I know it's our intent to make sure that if there were violations, SoCalGas is held accountable. And so it's not going to be a situation when the gas leak gets stopped and, you know, several months later when the report comes out, it's going to be a casual conversation. This is, you know, there will be accountability.
Yeah, and I may want to add that our experience in the past from, like, for example, San Bruno, when they had the pipeline explosion, is that the state agencies that are doing those investigations in the long term will hold Southern California Gas accountable for working to pay cost and losses and adjudicate those to all of the individuals that have been impacted. So it is a process, but there is history and doctrine associated with that, and we do have a pathway forward as we move forward and we get the results of the investigations.
All right.
Thank you very much. Next question, please.
Yes, sir. My name is Gabriel Callion, Save Puerto Ranch, as well as Renaissance Community Secretary. It seems like every question everybody's asking, you guys are going in big circles, answering, trying to answer, etc. I got one simple question for you guys, and the question is this. My son can answer his kindergarten. Why did it take Governor Brown's office 75 days to declare a state of emergency? What was he waiting for? We have hundreds of people sick, thousands of people relocating, and the state departments as well as the federal departments don't care about us at all. All we do is hear what you got to say, but nothing's being done about it.
Is that your question?
And my second question and my last question is, how long is it going to take for Governor Brown to shut it down? Enough's enough.
Thank you. So maybe I can take this particular question and just say that there was no waiting on the part of any state agency or department to respond to this particular event and engage with Southern California Gas. The governor was briefed all along. All those agencies that have statutory authority responded. He was understanding about how the response was going as it evolved. Everything that could be done was being done to mitigate the situation. And as we got more information, our recommendation to the governor was that there was a need to do a state of emergency. That state of emergency focuses the attention and also ensures that all of the responding entities, as well as some of the regulatory processes that can get streamlined so that some of the agencies that are represented here can, in fact, hold Southern Gas accountable, are then put in place. This is a process. There's no linear piece to any of this. These are several things, and there are many cases throughout the state where events happen and you have to get certain kinds of information before the governor actually declares a state of emergency. So I guess what I'm saying to you is there was no delay in any response that a state of emergency day one or day 15 would have mattered. The fact of the matter is that they all responded, and the governor's state of emergency now is in place to help these agencies ultimately hold Southern California Gas accountable.
Where is he today? Why isn't he here?
Yeah.
He declared state of emergency and
that.
BP oil within a day.
So let me just say
35 days?
This is a big state. The governor's got most of his cabinet represented here. He was down here 2 weeks ago.
Exactly. Why
personally,
wasn't he here?
Could not be here
Where
tonight.
Where is he?
So, hey, Mark.
Now we've got to concentrate on shutting this facility down. It's too dangerous
you
for
have any more
us
questions?
And the community. That will be it.
Thank you. Sir.
Yes, sir. My question, I'm following up with the gentleman about Porter Ranch.
Hold it together so we can hear the gentleman.
Sorry. Sir? The Porter Ranch used to be a very nice city, very clean, very good reputation. The gas company have damaged the city, and that will impact at least 200 or whatever, 20, 25% price decrease, you know. And there is a disclaimer on the any new buyer, and this is impacting on everybody's. You know, my request is this. Is there somebody is thinking about it? What can be done? Number one, number two question.
Okay,
is
let's be clear. Your question is, are we thinking about the economic losses and the impact to the community from an economic standpoint?
Yes, sir.
The answer is yes, we are. We are working. It's okay. So we are working with both the city and the county to collect that loss information. We have reached out to the Small Business Administration. We have looking at, through legislative action, other sort of programs that can be provided for you all. And so there is a process, again, to collect that data to determine what the total economic loss is. That will all be collected, and it will be used in working with Southern California Gas to be able to reimburse and make you whole and the community whole, again, as you were before the event took place.
I have a second question, sir.
Yes, second
is
question.
Is there this gentleman from Cal EPA Secretary, I have a question for him.
Yes.
Is there a way you can figure out if I live 1.5 mile, 2 miles away from the gas leak, what is the toxicity level? What is the parts per million my family is taking every day? If somebody's staying at 24/7, I was listening 1070 today. There is a scientist, he made findings that this is very dangerous. It's like a poison, sweet poison. Nobody know, but you're gonna have a consequences. You have to pay for it.
Okay. Did you hear the question, Matt?
Yes. I think you've heard the representatives from the Office of Environmental Health Hazard Assessments say that based on the information that they're seeing right now, that there isn't a significant health risk associated with the benzene levels that you're seeing there. But, and that assessment and their thinking and what went into their evaluation is on their website, so you can take a look at what they're looking at. Now, I will say also that they have appointed a panel of experts who will also be looking at this. We were talking about the fact that they'll be looking at modeling so they can see the dispersion. So we will continue to take a look at it. We are very concerned about the health ramifications of this kind of situation. That's why we've brought in these folks and why they're here today.
Sir, my question is this. If you are living 2 miles away from that leak, how I can determine what you are exposed to toxicity and methane level and benzene level, how it is affecting on your lungs, on your body, on your health. That's it. Mm-hmm. Is there a way you can tell us? If you are certain miles away, you are certain risk factor here? Mm-hmm. That's it. Thank you.
So let me explain how we've been looking at the toxicity data. We have what we call reference exposure levels, which are levels that have been publicly and peer-reviewed for benzene, and we compare them to the exposure measurements made by the monitoring. And what we see is that those exposure measurements are below the levels that would make us want to do something. They're below the levels of that are health values that we have for benzene. For non-cancer health effects, which are benzene affects your blood, so we're looking at that. We don't see that that's a risk. We're also looking at the cancer-causing properties of benzene. And so we've estimated cancer risk from benzene. From the background levels, it's actually about the same for background Los Angeles, the benzene levels. In fact, some of the measurements in Porter Ranch are actually lower than a lot of the areas of LA. So the gas,
Okay, let's, please, folks, we have a lot of people who still want to talk.
So we're always concerned about benzene. I would like to see zero benzene, but it's not going to happen because we all drive cars. There's other sources. The amount coming into the community from the gas would increase cancer risk very, very slightly.
I'm sorry, miss, I have to disagree with you. I was listening 1070 this morning. They said that the leaks happening through this, Aliso, you know, this leak, gas leak, it is very dangerous, it's poisonous, it's very toxic, and I can guarantee you, you want to hear that the analogy, whatever the analysis the fellow have, if you want, you can call 1070, and this is not my talk. This is an expert who is saying this thing.
Yes, well, we do have a panel of experts. They will be looking at the same data. They're independent of us. They're professors in the UC system to make an assessment of what they believe the risk is.
But I would say if you have data that they don't have access to or a scientist, share that with us. Come up afterwards and share it with us. What these folks are saying is that they've collected data on benzene and that the levels of benzene that are apparent in this community, science suggests, are not harmful and are actually similar to the background levels of benzene in LA. Don't have to necessarily agree with that, but that the data being collected on benzene is what we're assessing, and the science regarding risk and exposure is what we're basing that on.
Okay, great, thank you. Ma'am?
Great. Hello, so what it sounds like to me is that this board really serves to protect the gas company and their bottom line, and tomorrow, this is for the community. Tomorrow there is going to be a very important hearing where the AQMD is considering issuing an order for abatement, which they can use their authority to shut the facility down. And so please come out tomorrow, Granada Hills, Charter High School, 8 a.m. But if they don't do that, will Governor Brown step in to protect the community?
Okay.
And shut the facility down?
So can I tell you?
You have a question, ma'am?
Yeah, so
do you have a question?
Yeah, so my question is, since it looks like, and we know the CPUC has been in a lot of controversy, especially over the San Bruno incident, in protecting the utility, we want to make sure that this review that this board is doing and the future viability of this facility is a public process, it's accountable to the people, and it's transparent. So what are we going to do to ensure that happens rather than a report that just happens in the dark?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I can say that's certainly our commitment. It's not popular to come here and for many of you to hear that the facility can't be shut down now. We get that. And we will take that back, that there's an intensity in the community to want Aliso Canyon shut down. What we know, based on all of the information we collected and the jobs we do day to day, is if Aliso Canyon didn't exist tomorrow or was shut down tomorrow, there'd be a major portion of the Los Angeles Basin that would turn on their thermostats and not get heat. That's a problem, and it is what it is. That's a problem, but, and I'm just trying to be as clear as we can be, but as I said, we're committed to actually understanding what's the viability of changing that future for Aliso Canyon and the other storage fields. And it's not a simple process, and it's fairly complex, but your point is you want it to be publicly transparent, and you don't want it to be a report that happens in the dark up in Sacramento and then gets issued. So our commitment to you is to be transparent about how that report comes together and hopefully identify a way for the public, the community, to provide input to that, to really understand the decision-making behind ultimately what the report says.
And if CAISO said that this facility could be taken offline and they have contingency plans for the reliability of the grid, can you respond to that and what that means?
Yeah, CAISO is part of the interagency conversation, at least my understanding, and I'm not an expert compared to a lot of people up here, but is that it's not feasible to close Aliso right now. And so we're spending a lot of time understanding what it means not to have the facility online for the summer, for example, because as you remember, the proclamation, Senator Pavley's legislation says there's a moratorium on new gas into the facility until this safety review is complete. And we're not rushing the safety review. The safety review is going to be thorough. So it may be the case that Aliso, the gas doesn't get injected into Aliso for some months. And we're trying to work around actually how to balance that. When I say it would be a problem for Aliso to shut down permanently now, that is my understanding, is that it would impact the reliability, energy reliability in this larger community.
Okay, SoCalGas did put on their website that interview. I recommend you listen to it, where they say anything could be taken offline. We have a contingency plan. That's our job. Just want you to know that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Hi, good evening. Craig Galante, longtime Porter Ranch resident, 25 years. And first of all, thank you for being here. Okay. We certainly have some terrific representation here, some titles that I can't pronounce. We do not need more government. What we need is accountability, and we need to show where the teeth are in all of this. And with a lot of questions that have been rather direct, and I will get to my question, but I do have a couple of comments. 25 years here, 4 adjacent households to mine, including my own, cancer within the household. Okay, I live about as close as you can to SS25, and I moved out. Out of protection of my family, my pet, I moved out. And I welcome anybody, any senior executive from the SoCalGas or from Dogger or from PUC to come live in my house. You'll be really close to ground zero. You will be as close as you possibly can be. You can run up the hill, see the progress they're making. Open invitation. Bring your dog, bring your children, just like me. See what it feels like to be displaced from your home, have to set up your computers all over again. You move your utilities, make a bunch of phone calls, watch your wife get stressed out, all those things. Live it like I had to and like many others had to here. Okay, now to my question.
Okay, thank you.
It's been really, I had about four questions. Many of them already been asked. So, and it leads to, where is the accountability? You could drive a truck through the poor judgment, negligence, and absolute incompetence that has happened up on that hill. If the gas company can point to Dogger and say, we don't have to have a valve at the base of the well where the methane is, it's not on the top, it's at the bottom of the well. If they have the permission and the latitude to use a piece of galvanized pipe that was put in place 61 years ago, where's the accountability? And when questions, very pointed questions are asked, how did this happen? PUC points to Dogger, Dogger points to PUC, PUC points to gas company. How is it, at the protection of a very populous area, this is my question, how is it that there's not more teeth to the existing government bodies that are up here? We don't need more. We need you guys to have the teeth and exercise it. What is preventing that from happening today? Wade, you're right. Everybody here wants it shut down. And I do not want to see you guys get buffaloed by a bunch of really smart guys at the gas company explaining why this storage facility, which they can buy gas low prices during the summertime, store it, and then be more profitable when they pump it out in the wintertime. If they buffalo you guys and you do not have the teeth or the credibility to be in the positions that you're in. Senator, thank you for being here. Thank you. Push these people to achieve what they're here to do. You have an incredibly populous area. How is it that the accountability is not in place? That's my question. Thank you.
Okay. Let me try to take this one. Our, the focus right now has been to stop the leak. That has been the focus. We want to get the emergency, the crisis mitigated. Simultaneously, part of us being here tonight, part of what the legislators are doing, what the city council is doing, is addressing the issue of accountability. I 100% guarantee there will be accountability to Southern California Gas for either it's inaction, slow action, or pure negligence should that come up in the final investigations. There have been obviously cases in the past where huge fines have been levied against utilities as a result of not doing the things that they need to do to protect the community. This is not going to be any different. But right now, the issue is stop the leak, get the thing situated, make the community safe, get people back into their homes. And through this process here, through the governor's actions, through the legislature's actions, that accountability will come.
Well, I appreciate that. I just have one more point. We're in triage now, right? We have a major disaster, so you're absolutely right. We have to stop the leak. This was going to happen. It's a 61-year-old pipe. Everybody in Southern California knows you bury a piece of galvanized pipe for a water supply, a sprinkler, it corrodes, you have to replace it. It's impossible, it's inconscionable that I've been there 25 years and didn't know about this facility, nor how poorly it was run. Guys, step up.
Thank you, thank you. Okay, sir, I know you've been waiting. Thank you, very good point. Sir. Thank you.
My name is Hal Bass. I'm a 30-year resident of Porter Ranch. We heard reference to the 1989 Loma Prieta quake. On Sunday, it'll be 22 years since we went through the 6.7 Northridge earthquake in this community. What I'm concerned about We've heard about the possibility, although you folks tried to reassure us that there won't be a blowout, but we know that this is earthquake country, fire country. What I want to ask, and maybe the council member can answer it, Susnan Boulevard would be a major egress for first responders and for people to exit the community if it were connected to Granada Hills over Aliso Canyon. That should be done, and I want to ask, why isn't it being done? Why isn't this a priority? Because one day we're going to be sorry that we didn't have that.
Thank you. Councilman, you want to address that?
I'll just be brief on this. How many people want Cessna to go all the way through to Granada Hills? How many don't?
Well,
that's why it's not done. So well, the plan.
It shouldn't be a vote. It should be priority for safety.
Sure, I'm answering the question. The plan, actually, that's not why it's not done. The plan was actually approved some 30 years or so ago to do that. And the cost today would be roughly $1 billion or so to do it. The only way that the city would be able to pay to have the bridge actually go through in full completion all the way to Granada Hills is probably a special assessment to each and every one of you to pay for it. And the will isn't there of the people to do that. People don't want it to go all the way through. So
I can't believe it would cost $1 billion to build a bridge. But one thing you could do is ask the gas company to pay for it.
Thank you, sir. Sir, please.
I'm a Porter Ranch resident. I have 2 points.
Two points.
To the gentleman's point about what can be done immediately, 6 weeks ago on this stage, Robert Kennedy Jr. stood here and said, when this kind of thing happens elsewhere in the country, gas leak 101 is you run a line from the leak a quarter of a mile away from homes, you light it on fire. He called it flaring. He said it's basically standard operating procedure. The gas company is not doing it. He says he has repeatedly asked the gas company why they're not doing it. He said they refused to answer. He called it lawyering up. And I'd like to see if I can get an update on that, because it seems like that would be an immediate position to take. The second point, Senator Pavley was kind enough to reference earlier tonight that for future wells, the concern is for wells built prior to 1953, which means a well has to be 64 years old or older to draw increased scrutiny. So a well that might be 63 years old is okay, but 64 years old is not. Doesn't that strike anybody as just a little bit crazy? Why should anybody here have confidence in a well that's more than 50 years old, but not quite 64, that those wells aren't going to have the same result as the well that we're all here for tonight for?
Okay, thank you. Let's see if Jason can answer your question on the flaring.
Thank you.
I may be able to cover them both.
Both. That's correct. We'll get a twofer.
Sir, the first question with regard to the flaring, I indicated earlier, there's a concern about the safety of the capture of the gas at the site. The division, I don't think anybody really wants to see a compromise of worker or public safety by trying to capture the gas in a way that's not safe. We know that the SoCalGas has a plan forward for incineration of the gas, but at this point the question really is how to safely capture the gas and get it to that incinerator. We are working with them. We are reviewing their plans. I know other agencies that have actual permitting authority over that are looking at this question about safety and about how to get that gas capture system installed as quickly as possible.
And Jason, because you've explained it to me on this very question, the issue here is that the leak isn't coming from a very well-defined area. So if it was, then you could put a pipe onto it and then flare it or incinerate it. In this case, it's kind of coming almost out of a chasm, And so then the issue is, how do you put a hood or a tent over that chasm in a way that doesn't bring in oxygen? Because when you do that, you create a potential, you know, explosive threat. Right?
That is correct. And the gentleman who raised the notion earlier, I'm very interested in hearing that and being able to pass that along to our experts. We are actually asking experts from the Lawrence Berkeley, Lawrence Livermore, and Sandia National Labs to help us evaluate the safety of that kind of a system. To your second question.
Wells that, let's say, are 63
you.
Years old.
Thank you. The integrity of the well question or the review, date, age somewhat matters because of the date that the well construction standards were established, but more importantly is really the quality of the well. And as we look to do the evaluation of the wells, really the first thing we're going to look at are things like, is there cement separating the metal from the earth in the well construction? And then move through the prioritization scheme of wells that, by dint of their construction, some of it may have to do with age, but really more of it is how they were built, which ones need to get reviewed first so that we can make sure that we get through the highest risk wells first and expeditiously as we go through the review of all of the wells in the field.
But I would just add something that I think is important, which is, one, starting today, there are emergency regulations in place moving forward that require the daily review or the daily monitoring of every wellhead and every storage field across the state. But additionally, that division is starting a permanent rulemaking instead of not emergency regs that are temporary, but permanent moving forward, not only to require that monitoring moving forward, but potentially to require stronger standards for well construction, regardless of the age. Because you raise a good point. It's not that, you know, we should look at wells that are 63 years old, but not that are 61 years old. And these permanent regulations will potentially require stronger standards regardless of the age of the well.
Thank you.
Thank you. I want to loop back to Secretary Laird. I may have missed you. Did you have a comment?
I'll reserve it till later.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Okay. Ma'am? Question?
I have one comment to the congressman. That's based on the court order for SoCalGas to relocate within 24 to 72 hours. Just to let you know, we have no way of knowing how to report violations of that. I know personally that I'm a case in which that was violated. So I don't know if there's anything you could do to help us know how to report those violations. So that's one. That's just a comment to let you know that the court order has been violated. We just don't know how to report it. With respect to all of you, I want to thank you for your patience in trying to help our community come to understand what's going on within our community. To thank you for your time, because I know that you guys all must be exhausted, because we're pretty exhausted. But the question I have, the world is watching California. The world is watching Porto Ranch. We know that. We see that in the reports from Scientific America, reports in Finland, everywhere. And we know that there's state-of-the-art technology out there in other countries that are not using below-the-ground wells that were intended to be used for oil or some other purpose. They are using designated storage units that were intended above ground for gas purposes only. And because they're above ground, they're able to address any types of leaks more rapidly. I know that you can't just shut off the gas, and because it's not just our little tiny town that's going to be impacted. There's a lot of other people that'll be impacted. But we certainly can consider the fact that with each well that's identified to be old, that you build a well above ground or storage above ground that is state of the art and can accommodate things much better than the archaic technology that we're using now. We shouldn't be using something from the dinosaur age. There's no reason to.
Well, I think that's one subject that will be explored in that sort of broad look at the future viability of underground storage fields. Can the gas, one, how much natural gas do we need in the future? But then two, how can we store gas? So that, I believe, will definitely be considered.
And just, you know, our property values will continue to hemorrhage as long as they're up there. So, and that's not just going to be our property values, that's going to be our ability to get loans. It's going to be our, the business's ability to open other businesses as well. So while I totally get that you can't just shut it down, as long as they're up there and as long as there's underground wells up there, we're never going to be able to be made whole.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it. Thank you. Ma'am? Sure. Hold on one second.
Really important, because it is very important. On the relocation efforts, that's what we took them into court for as well. You have to, if you put a request for relocation, you have a period of time. We've also, on your behalf, impaneled retired judges that you can meet with within 24 hours, and it's a binding decision. If you have extra and ordinary out-of-pocket costs or special needs for relocation, if the gas company or the relocation companies are not responding to your needs, I'm going to give you a phone number as well. And it's 818-700-3600. Also on our city attorney's website, Mike Fuhrer's website, they, since the city attorney spearheaded this as well on our behalf, have listed how to get in touch with all of those and meet with those judges. We also have where you can, in the same day, have an appointment with them online, face-to-face, over the internet, and you can come to our office to do that as well in Chatsworth. So we've set all that up for you as well. So I wanted to answer that woman's question. Thank you. Yeah, the phone number again is, somebody get it? I looked it up. 818-700-3600. I closed my browser. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, ma'am, question.
Thank you. My name is Lisa Nealon. I'm a resident of Renaissance in Porter Ranch. I understand that you're all the experts. This morning, I've listened to all the experts, and I take you at your word. This morning, I woke up to a number of articles online, one of which was commented and noted was the LA Times. There are two articles that are on a site called la.curbed.com. There are two very specific articles. They're there right now that have very disturbing, detailed information in details about the air, about what is there, what is leaking. And this is leading me to a health question. I'm being told it's okay. I'm being told that the air is fine. I'm being told that the benzene is not a problem and the methane is not a problem. We are still in our home. We've had the filtration units put in. They went in very quickly, and I'm very appreciative for them. But to you, I would like to know two things. Number one, is this information correct in these articles? Because if it is, it doesn't sound like the same answers. Two, to the health point, the methane is what reduces and disperses or takes away the oxygen. Just in the last 2 days, my husband at a medical appointment was told that his blood oxygen level is unusually low. Today, my dog went to a vet appointment. The vet happened to check him, unusually low. That tells me, I don't know why, all of a sudden, it's my husband, myself, and three dogs, and two have an unusually low level of blood oxygen. So I ask you, is the detailed information in these articles accurate? And if it is, I don't think it is safe out there.
Doctor, would you like to speak
up? If you would give me those articles, I will give them to our independent science panel, and I will take a look at them.
Hold on.
So in all fairness, because we don't have the articles in front of us, it's impossible to say. So what we're trying, what the notion of setting up this independent panel is non-governmental people, experts from around the state. names and credentials are online, and the idea of the independent panel is to take all of the information and to provide their own independent assessment. OEHA, we need to figure out a way to make that public and ultimately potentially interactive for very specific questions. But I think to start responding to the LA curve or curb?
It's la.curbed, curbed.com.
Got it.
And the two articles were posted this morning. They both reference Porter Ranch and the gas leak. They have an aerial photograph, and one of them discusses the, quote, partial blowout or the recent failures to close the leak. And the other one is really about the benzene and the methane, and that it is much more dangerous than the gas company is telling us. So I combine all this information together, and then I find out that I have a 7-pound chihuahua that blood oxygen level is unusually low. I can't keep him in the house. He has to go out. So I want to know. Maybe I shouldn't have stayed. Maybe I shouldn't have listened when they said it's okay. So I just want to know. If someone can check these articles, check the facts. If the facts are correct, please tell us.
Would you do me a favor, the lady that's standing right here behind you, give her your contact information, your phone number, and we will follow up on that and get back to you specifically.
Thank you.
But I want to say specifically, always what, I don't know if it stated the sources of that article, where they found that information, if it described that.
Yes, there are quotes and there are references.
Okay, so great. We'll look that up, but please give the lady behind you your information, and we'll follow up specifically on that.
Okay.
And also share it with the neighborhood council so that others can see it, not just the person who asked the question.
Yeah. Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Young man.
I have two different topics. It's about my fish and my school. I'm first going to talk about my fish. I don't know if it's the gas that's getting to him because he keeps on like laying down on his side, and I think that he's dying. So like, could the gas be affecting animals too, not just people?
Since we're not medical people, I'm going to turn to our...
So most toxic chemicals affect animals just like they affect people. So I can't answer the question whether your fish is sick from the gas.
Okay, then about my school. So I'm a fifth grader at Castle Bay, and they had to relocate us to Sunnybrae. But I'm kind of wondering if they had 7 air filters and if they have enough for all the kindergartners and they have enough for pretty much everybody that needs them, how come they're not giving them to all the schools first? They're giving them to all the parents, and then when all the kids need them most.
So to be clear, your question is, how would they get the filters to all the schools?
Why don't they?
Why don't they give them to the schools first?
Yes, that's quite a good question. That's a good question.
Sorry, it's hard to actually hear the questions up here, but the specific question is that the schools don't have air filters that they need, and did you ask why they don't have them first?
Yeah.
Got it. Also, we have 7 air filters, as I said before, but they gave them all to the kindergartners, and I'm thinking if there are 6 grades in our school, they should put all the kindergartners in one classroom and then put all the grades in just one classroom with their own grades and then just give them one air filter in that room.
Well, I would think... you know, that they need to provide enough air filters for all the grades so that the grades don't have to move around. And so if they haven't, that's something we will follow up on immediately.
It just says kind of...
And can I add a quick thing? You're in the fifth grade. If I'm still doing this when you graduate from the 12th grade, come and ask me for a job.
It's going. Those are good questions. Thank you. Sir.
You know, I don't think I can follow that.
That's a hard one to follow. Yes, that's true.
It's good to know that our future is in good hands. Good job. Mike Benedetto, Granada Hills South Neighborhood Council. I've talked to many of our stakeholders over the last month or so. I will try and be brief. As a matter of fact, I got some requests even while I was standing in line. But the first one goes to, in relationship to the 115 wells nearby and the 120 more at Susanna Pass, and in addition to all the other wells, you know, it was first brought to the attention by the gas company that, well, when you sell a house, it is mandatory that you put in a safety valve. Why didn't they do that then if it was their idea that they knew we needed to have this?
Let's, Jason, let Jason answer that question. It's a good question.
Is the question if I...
in here. I was shocked when I drove by the park the other day and saw two people playing. What are people doing in the park? There's no one should be up there now exposed to this. And not everybody knows is the problem. The people here are educated know, but there's other people who come here and walk, and some people in their home are not paying attention. It's negligent if we don't educate those people and let them know that the air is not healthy and not to go outside and not to run. I'm also a triathlete, and I train, and I run that whole loop up there. I'm staying away from there. I haven't done it for months since I found out about this. When you exercise, you're pulling in more oxygen, as the science will tell you. You're increasing your rate of taking these things in.
Thank you. I don't have the answer specific tonight on the postings, but it's something that I will follow.
Maybe the folks here can have public announcements, put signs up in the community, in the neighborhood, so everybody else knows, don't go out. Try and stay in, stay out of this air. And this benzene is a major, major problem. And when you go home tonight, everybody, they're gonna have it on the news again tonight. They'll show it, that scientist. I saw it this morning on the news. The second part is property taxes here. We all have paid or are going to pay our property taxes. For those who sent in ahead of time, maybe the governor who's in charge of that can waive for all these zip codes the property taxes, because we're being impacted with the financials that we're putting out and our losses. I'm asking our representatives here if we could talk to the governor and waive our property tax to people in this zip code. Gentlemen, I'm asking you.
So a while ago, I actually put in a motion to reduce the property taxes here. I spoke personally with our county assessor. The county assessor, not the governor, is the one that actually comes up with assessed values. And so I spoke with Jeff Prang. He's the county assessor. He couldn't do anything on property taxes until the governor actually declared an emergency or proclaimed an emergency. And so under that, now he could. He's put a team on it to start monitoring property values as well as costs. And so we'll be sending out information as his team has the information to send, and so as soon as we have that, we'll send it out. So that's being looked at right now.
That's good. That's the first step, but can they waive them for all these people for this year with the damage and the tremendous financial burden that these people are going through? And one final thing, and I appreciate everybody's patience. I know I waited a long time, so thank you.
Let me just say one thing real quick. The wonderful facility that we're in is being provided for us by the church and a number of church volunteers that need to, I got a little note that they need to move on. So let's try to keep the comments to questions. We want to make sure we get to everybody. So
I'm just about done.
Go ahead.
When we had the earthquake here, President Clinton came down, FEMA came down, we received checks in the mail. Can the governor contact the president? How do we get FEMA involved in this? How do we make this where it's going to be taken care of immediately? We didn't have to ask for checks. A check showed up in my house and the other people who lived there in the mail. Raise your hand if you were living here at that time and received those checks. We were tremendously impacted. Some of these houses were destroyed, red tagged. The government took care of the people. Gentlemen, can you help work on that, please? And my last thing is I want to thank everybody who took the time to come here. Everybody here is tremendously impacted. I heard someone talk about that the governor has lots of different things. It's a big state. This is the major emergency. I watch the news. I don't know of another emergency bigger than this in this state. Why is the governor not in the seat over here next to these gentlemen? We need to have, he's the top dog.
Okay, just with, in the essence of time, do you have a final question?
No, that was my final statement.
Okay.
So my question is, why is the governor not sitting here when this is the biggest catastrophe happening in this state today?
Thank you.
And the answer, I'm listening.
Let me just move on, thank you. Ma'am.
Hi, my name is Christina Grana, and I'm a Porter Ranch resident. Back in October, at the end of October, my 15-year-old son came down with a pneumonia-like illness, and he almost died. And we rushed him to the hospital. He had to get his lungs x-rayed because he had lost the ability to breathe. He was very sick for a very long time, and at one point, we didn't know what was going on. He was getting nosebleeds. He has a jeopardized immune system, so he is, you know, extra sensitive. He was diagnosed with chronic lung disease. How do I prove or disprove that the impact of the gas leak affected my son's physical well-being? Our family has been so stressed because he is so sick, and we have tried, it's been a month now, to be relocated, and it's been a disaster trying to get relocated. It's just been a nightmare. I did notice not long ago that there are no birds in my backyard. I have a huge backyard with a beautiful view of the gas leak. There are no birds. What does that mean? Does that mean that the wildlife understands that there is poison in the air? So my biggest question is, what the hell is really going on? Because I feel like there's a lot of misinformation out there. The gas company has probably the best PR company in the world feeding information to the people, the residents of Porter Ranch. So if the air is not toxic, why are they relocating people? Why are the birds dead? What is going on? I'm getting so much information, misinformation, things that people see and share. Even my neighbors are arguing about what is really going on, if they should leave, if they should stay. Really, I mean, what do we do? I mean, it's a simple question. What do we do? My son is still alive, thank you, God. But he's very sick. He just had a nosebleed, nose hemorrhage the other day. We finally got to stay in a hotel 20 miles away from school. At least we're in a hotel now. And Mitch, wherever you are, Mitchell, I tried calling him several times, begging for help, because really it's falling on deaf ears.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Did you want to comment?
Well, I would just say, first of all, I can't imagine what you're going through.
It's been pretty devastating.
And it's intense to hear.
I've got your card, Mitchell. I'm sorry, you're doing a great job, but I've called you so many times and nobody has responded to me. Nobody. All I hear is, we're overwhelmed. We're overwhelmed. That's all I have heard. And I'm overwhelmed.
Right.
These people are overwhelmed. These people.
And if it's taking you that amount of time to be relocated up to a month, that's unacceptable.
It's terrible.
Totally understand.
Today, I finally signed a lease on a property for my family. But let me tell you, I have suffered the consequences. Just saying.
I would say this, which is the people up here and the government don't have an incentive to do anything like a whitewash. We're not in league with SoCal Gas in terms of what they're explaining. What we're trying to do is get as much information out there in as clear a way as possible, and we can do better. I mean, you hear us and we talk
much
in technical
better
terms. Yeah, and point taken, and we're working to do better. We've got a website, we're giving daily updates. We've tried to put a lot of the technical data analysis into language that everyday people can actually understand.
But it's conflicting. There's conflicting information, and everybody's confused. I'm telling you.
Yeah.
You guys are well-educated people, but even you're stumped at times during this meeting. I mean, some questions you can't answer, you can try to the best of your ability, but really nobody really knows what is really going on except for the gas company, and they can be protected by the spin they put on with the public relations people.
Well, I can tell you we're going to keep on trying to get smart, independent minds actually assessing the situation. That independent panel has like 10 of the top scientists from University of California, different campuses, et cetera, and they're gonna put information out as transparently as possible. Now, will that not necessarily, will that create consensus among the scientific community? No, but we're trying to get as much independent information out there as possible.
You also need people who can think out of the box, creative people, people who are not just scientists, people who can solve problems. There are not enough problem solvers. There are scientists who are very logical and don't understand empathy or know how to solve a situation a certain way. So you need not just scientists. They're data collectors. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sir?
Hi. Hello. My name is Matt Novak, and I've been living here since year 2000 in Porter Ranch, north of Cessnon. And by the way, nobody wants Cessnon to go all the way through. We already complained because there's street racers driving 55 miles an hour or faster, and I've seen many street races up there. Nobody in their right mind wants that to go through. So anyway, I have 3 points, 3 questions, has to do with improvements of well technology that the senator mentioned, also health standards, and with the Air Quality Management District is discussing, and also the councilman's point regarding the filtering with relocation. With increasing standards at the last Saturday's Resources Board meeting, I heard that the CAS company has had issues like this of long-term leaks in cities of Montebello, Playa del Rey, and other areas besides here. And I can tell you, like I said, I've lived here for 11 years, and I wrote down a couple of dates. Summer of 2001, October 2010, September 2013, there were significant per capita, or whatever that name is, smell in my yard. The first time it happened was only a year after I moved here, and I called the gas company. Hey, there's something wrong. There's gas at my house. You know, they come, they inspect. It was quite obvious it was outside. It was not my house. But I didn't notice that. I didn't put that together in 2001. In 2013, I put it together because 3 of my neighbors also smelled it. So the bullshit that this just happened back in October is just that. It's been happening for years. So my question is, and this is again something I heard on the radio today, how many wells are leaking that have been tested? I heard a number of 5. 5 wells are currently leaking. Can somebody answer that question?
I think that question's probably to me. I don't have the exact number, but I will get that for you. The number of wells out of the 115?
Let's let him answer. Let's let him answer, please. Okay, look, folks, if we want everybody to have a chance to speak, let us get to the questions, the answers that we can provide you, and so that we can move on because we have a time limit.
I absolutely understand the frustration and you know anger about that, but the reality is that sitting here right here today, I can't tell you which of the 115 wells is leaking, which ones are presently being reworked, but I can get that information for this body, and we can get that available.
I mean, can you confirm that in just the last couple of weeks that there has been some tests done by the agencies that are sitting up here and there is other wells that are leaking?
I can tell you that I know that one well in particular is leaking a lot. And with regard to other wells, I would have to get back to you about what that number is. I don't have
okay.
that number.
Well, just from my personal experience, it's quite obvious and from other of my neighbors that this has been going on for a long time. And I'm not saying it's been leaking like it is now, of course not, but there has, and I mentioned this to the woman from the Southern California Air Quality Management District when they had the meeting at the other church a month ago. And she was She didn't know anything about it. And she'd asked me for these dates, so I wrote these dates down. Another question, LA County Health, the doctor that came to that meeting about a month ago, he talks about standards, the standards that are measured for the per capita and the benzene. And he's talking about what I would assume is OSHA standards, someone who works, you know, with this material for 8 hours a day. But he cannot intelligently tell me, or I'm asking you, I'm asking Dr. Marty here to tell me what research has been done regarding 24/7 exposure to infants, children, and the elderly, not 8 hours a day working in the fields.
Yeah, so the standards that we are comparing the measured levels to are not occupational standards. They're not worker standards. They're actually standards developed with the general public and sensitive subjects in mind. So we have, they're quite a bit lower than any occupational standards. We have uncertainty factors that take into account the fact that you and I are different, and we have different body composition, different gender, different ways of metabolizing things, that infants and children can be especially susceptible. So we actually have a very low number for benzene for chronic effects on the blood-forming bone marrow. So I don't know, I wasn't at the meeting, I don't know what the LA County health guy was saying or which numbers he was referring to.
He kept referring to, and I took some little bit of notes, but he kept referring to workers working all day around these materials, and you know that they hadn't had any ill effects, and they were working for 10 odd years. Well, again, who cares? That's 8 hours a day, and that's a middle-aged person. That's not a six-year-old kid. That's not an 11-year-old, my 11-year-old son. That's not a two-month-old baby. I mean, come on. And it's 24/7. It's not 8 hours.
Yeah, our standards are for, the chronic standard is for 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for a lifetime. That's okay. What our standards are.
Well, I appreciate that. My last question, Councilman, I don't know where he went, but he was mentioning that even if you relocate, you can still get weatherization and filters. Apparently, the gas company doesn't agree, because I was in communication with them. They were supposed to get back to me. I had a one phone call tag regarding the filters. As soon as they put me in a hotel, no more phone calls. And I called them back, no more phone calls. So if they want me to relocate back to my house, don't they think they would, you know, keep in communication? So anyway, I just wanted to tie that loop. They seem to be dropping the ball on that. Thank you.
What we've been told by the gas company and the relocation companies and airfield, they're prioritizing. So for the folks that this is what they're telling us. I don't believe half of what they told me anyway. I don't know which half to believe, but what they've said is they're prioritizing. If you've already relocated, they're trying to catch up on the weatherization and filtration systems for the ones that haven't first. That's what they're saying. So what I would suggest is for that, there isn't a mediation or stipulated agreement where they have to do it in a certain amount of time. But at that point, keep calling and make sure you're on that list. And if you have a problem, call my office and we're happy to follow through.
I appreciate it.
Thank you, sir. Ma'am?
Hi, my name is Alona, and I'm from Granada Hills. I read article recently, and Puerto Ranch gas leak was named as a small Chernobyl. And ironically, I'm Chernobyl survivor. And you know, it's really scary for me. Everything whatever says in this meeting is great. And I doubt it, you guys have incredible amount of knowledge, resources, whatever you fix right now with this, I don't know, gas leaking, whatever happened. But I don't have control on it, yes? I have control on my life, and my life dramatically changed second time. It was happened in 1986, which was really scary, and my government Russia, which said to me, oh, don't worry about it. Everything is fine. You just get to your house and clean everything, whatever you wear, and wash your hair. Right now, I feel the same way. I cannot, my life change. It's great community. We walk around, the outgoing people, Puerto Ranch, Granada Hills, Chatsworth, Northridge, we all have kids, we all have animals. Our life was running, jogging, I don't know. Right now, I mentally wake up every single day reading articles about that. I close my window, I cannot open it. Window according to what's happening in the air. And I don't know, I think all guys feel the same way. We became a prison in our own houses, which we got pay on it. We pay property tax on it. We pay gas company. Our I don't know if you know that, bill for water and power became thousands of dollars per 2 months, which I don't get it why I should pay for water and power thousands of dollars. And I don't know why I need to pay gas company, okay, right now. And I don't know why I was dreaming to come. The biggest reason me to come to United States, it was my dream, first of all. And second, I was scared for my kids to live in Chernobyl atmosphere. I don't know if people know what does it mean, Chernobyl. It's the biggest atomic explosion by man-made. Right now, it's a second stage in my life. I feel the same way. And who is controlling? I cannot control on this. My life is changed. And thousands of people too. And also, yeah, it's easy to say relocate it. Do you ever in your entire life change countries? How easy to say relocate it? Yes, I am maybe take my briefcase and relocate it. But how safe my house will be? It will stay how many months empty? Who can?
Ma'am, let me ask you.
Yes.
Do you frame a question?
Yes. Yes, I frame because I have a lot of questions, but people ask about property tax. Okay. My question is why I should pay property tax.
We may have answered your questions already.
Yes, but my question is right now, simple question. If people relocate it and I decided to relocate it, how safe my house will be?
Okay, so your question is how can we assure you how safe your house will be?
Yes, for how long I need my house will stay empty. Right now, it look like people has their own houses, house has life because it's a people, it's a soul of people, it's a kids, he's going to school, it's a friends, everything. Right now, everything is destroyed.
Our answer to you on this issue is
yes.
That everything is being done to stop the leak and get people as soon as possible back into the community. We want to make sure part of the effort here and all of the agencies, as well as the city and the county, and our partners at the federal government level, working to hold the gas company accountable. Two different buckets. The first bucket is fix the problem, get it safe, and the second bucket, get you back into your homes and recover the impact, recover the costs that you have incurred. That is the objective that we want to do for you. In doing that, we have identified deficiencies. We have identified new regulations that we want to put forth, whether it's through legislation, through the governor's action, these agencies to be able to put certain regulations in place or streamline those regulations. So those are all of the aspects that are happening. I can't tell you definitively right now when you will get back into your house, but I can tell you that is the objective, is for you to get back into your home.
I understand it's a huge goal and I understand everybody want to meet this goal, but I'm a simple person, okay? Look like millions of people. Did you see half of the people left? Because really, you don't touch their soul. Whatever they come to you to ask a question, it's just you, yes, it's goal, huge goal, but everybody is my life, okay? It's my life. And I don't know how long it will take me and what I will catch you. Every time my kid got sick, I was thinking about, oh my God, it's Chernobyl. It's Chernobyl happened. Something wrong with me, I'm thinking. Do you know you cannot get out from my head? The same will be, you cannot get out from the people's head.
I think the most important way we can respond to you is acknowledge just how impactful it is to you. And I'm sure we had several hundred seats here tonight. Most people didn't actually get to talk, but my guess would be most people have stories about impacts on their life. And so one is for us to actually come here and hear that. And so that's important. So I just want to first of all acknowledge just how disruptive and impactful it is. And I think that's important for all of us to hear. I think it's also important when the leak is over for us to be able to very clearly say that the air in the community no longer has these various odorants and compounds, et cetera, because you need to feel safe moving back to your house. And that's something we're committed to doing. So when the leak is stopped, actually doing continuing the air quality monitoring so that you have confidence you can move back to your house and it's safe.
Look, I understand
Ma'am, let me say, we're about 5 minutes or 6 minutes till 10 o'clock. We're gonna stop at 10 because the people here need to move forward. So one question, please just make it a question and we'll be able to try to answer that question for you so we can try to get through everybody here. Sir.
Okay, I'm Ken Piper, Dr. Ken Piper. I'm a geologist and geophysicist. I'm retired from the U.S. Department of Interior, where I worked on oil and gas stuff in the federal offshore. So I have understanding of the Dogger plumbing issues as well as the geologic issues. But what I want to know is where we can get information. My concern here is that when you kill that well, that there may still be other points of leakage. As the gentleman ahead of me here mentioned, he smells it, he's been smelling it on and off for years. And I know that after the 94 earthquake, they used a lot of the data from those wells to identify faults and fractures. All the wells, when they're drilled, they're logged. The oil companies know where the fractures intersect the wells. It's not generally public information, but in 94, it was used to help identify some of the faults that were involved in the earthquake. So that information should be available to the gas company if they don't already have it. And I was looking to see if it's available to the public. I can't find it, but I'd like to know where that is because those fractures are a likely source of leakage. You know, for example, if the gas company was putting gas in the field at too high a pressure, it could open up some of the fractures enough for the gas to get through. So I don't know whether they were doing that. The other thing that's related to it is when those houses west of Tampa and north of Cessnan were built, did the city approve that development? And did they have information from the 94 earthquake that there were fractures there that may have gone down and intersected that field? And so that may not have been a good development to put in.
Okay, let's just see if go ahead.
I'm happy to take that question, and thank you for your question. I wanted to, with regard to the other question as well, make sure this was very clear with regard to leaks and with regard to the well integrity. That is the point of the evaluation that we're going to be doing on all of the wells in the formation.
This is more than the wells. This is for fractures as well.
Yes, the review that we will be doing is about whether or not the wells have integrity. One of the things that we will be looking at is the tests that have been run before and the new tests that we require them to run. You're well aware of things like, I'm certain, temperature logs, noise logs, as well as pressuring up the well and those kinds of integrity tests. Those are the kinds of things that we're going to be requiring. With regard to the well data, all of the data for the wells in the Aliso Canyon field, as well as most of the rest of the state, but all of them in the Aliso Canyon field, that is available on the Department of Conservation's website. There are PDF records that are available there. If you go to the link that is for something called Well Finder, you can search by oil and gas field. This is obviously the Aliso Canyon field. Not to get too far into the weeds, I would suggest that you sort out for gas storage wells because, as you well know, this area has oil production as well above it. But that information is available there on Well Finder.
Okay. Now, aside from the wells.
I'm sorry. We have one last question, folks, because we have a hard stop at 10. They have to close the church. I've got a note here. Last question, ma'am.
Yes. Hi. I'm a Granada Hills resident with two young children who attend schools in the hills there. I want to know who the principal of my school should contact to get the air filtration systems in each classroom.
I'm happy to take this one on myself.
Go ahead.
Well, Richard or I, but let me just give you my email, or I can give you my card. Wade, W-A-D-E, Crowfoot@gov.ca.gov.
Well, at gov.ca.
Sorry, gov.ca.gov.
Okay.
Because that seems ridiculous.
That's my primary
that
concern.
That seems totally ridiculous.
Okay, thank you.
One more, I implore you. One more.
Okay, last question. We want to finish by 10 o'clock. It's 9:58.
This was raised by the 6:30 evening news by Channel 5 tonight. In addition to the concerns we've all expressed so far, toxicity levels of benzene, property values, they raised the specter of a potentially even much more dire concern. As we all may know, methane is highly flammable. It's my understanding that the fix undergoing right now concerns drilling. Sparks fly. What are the potential of a spark flying and a major explosion happening?
It's a good question. So, Jason, answer this as directly and clearly as you can, because we've asked the same question.
The relief wells are approximately 1,500 feet away, and both of them have pads that are approximately 200 to 300 feet lower in elevation. They're sufficiently isolated, in our view, to keep an ignition source away from SS-25.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Folks, we're going to have to conclude tonight. Let me say thank you for coming.
Working for Senator Pavley's office, is there a way to continue this conversation for those who don't have their questions answered, that they can submit questions to you all?
Going to get to that.
Okay.
So
we do, but the church is closing down.
We're confined by the church. We've gone an hour over, so we're going to have to.
Can we do this? Can we give an email address? And if you're asking a question tonight that you didn't have an opportunity to ask, that you can email it to us? Because, I mean,
For Senator Pavley's staff, do you want them to email your office?
Yeah.
Wait, okay. Actually, we people that have health questions can meet them outside, and I'll also give you our email address, but we can't get to all of you. But we will, for the health questions, give you an email address.
So let me give you a final email.
Please do air testing at Mangle Elementary School.
If you have questions associated with this that you did not get asked, you can email us at calcaloes.ca.gov. And we will respond to your questions. We will coordinate that and get it to all the members and get it back to you. Okay? Questions, Q-U-E-S-T-I-O-N-S, at cal, C-A-L-O-E-S, dot C-A, dot G-O-V. That's not what he said. The church has to close. This is coming to an end. If you want to go outside and be able to talk to us, we'll spend a few minutes with you outside. But we need to now close the church. So, thank you. Thank you.